Good afternoon, friends, delegates who have registered for this program, past presidents S.R. Nair, Rajmohan Nair, Vivek Govind, and other managing committee members, senior vice president Nirmala Ishi there, vice president Balakrishnan, I can see all other managing committee members. Very good afternoon to each one of you. Really good that we could do this program when everybody is talking about lockdown and slowing down and closing down and containment. Here in our own limits, within our limits, we are in this program. Let's start the program with a minute's silent prayer. Just praying for all of us and all around us. Thank you and good afternoon once again, and let's begin the program with a welcome address formally by the Management Education Program Chair for KMA, Past President, Chartered Accountant, Mr. Vivek Krishna Govind.
Thank you. President Madhav, most distinguished past presidents, committee members, and my dear delegates, good afternoon to all of you once again. I think we are all very, very keenly waiting to listen to a topic which I think bits and pieces of which we may all have heard somewhere. The term Ikigai is something which probably we would have read somewhere, but we frankly, most of us do not really know what it means or what is the story behind it and what is the philosophy, the guiding force behind the Ikigai concept. And who better than our close friend and past president of KMA, S.R. Nair. He will present it, I'm sure, in the most lucid manner, and we would have loved to do this as a physical session. In fact, that was when we initially had this discussion about organizing a workshop on this topic probably 3-4 months ago. The idea was that when we reopen with physical sessions in KMA, this would be the first session that we would plan whereby we would have a hands-on workshop probably for about 25 or 30 odd people. This is what we had in mind. But unfortunately, the second wave has really, you know, taken a toll on all our plans, and we thought there is no point trying and waiting for a physical session. So we will start with the workshop, and I'm sure once we reopen again, we will, you know, we will definitely invite SR back, and probably he can do a post Ikigai review session or a you know, an implementation session of all the concepts which he has taught us today. So at the outset, let me welcome all of you. Let me first welcome all the delegates present here. We have, I think, almost 50 odd registrations, which is fantastic for a weekday afternoon. And obviously, it is because the speaker is somebody who's so close to all of us, and the topic is something which has evoked a lot of interest in all of us, which is the reason why we've got such a phenomenal response to a paid workshop, which is in the virtual mode. Now, a quick word of introduction. It would be rather audacious on my part to try and introduce SR to this group, to probably for any group in which is connected to management in Kerala. It really doesn't make sense to try and to introduce SR formally. I think we all know who he is. We all know what he's done, and we all know his contagious energy and enthusiasm. And we are all fortunate that you know, we share a very close friendship with him. He has been a guiding force for all of us, not just in KMA, but in various other, in our, not just, you know, the association side or the professional side, but even on a personal level, he has guided us through so many difficult times, and that's the kind of person he is. So I'm not really going to venture out into a very formal introduction, but a few quick words about him. He's has a career of almost 3.5 decades, 35 plus years. Firstly, he started off his career with some of the large corporates, and thereafter turned entrepreneur, started the Team Frontline, which was a pioneering organization in the IT space about 3 decades ago. He also co-founded many other organizations, including Stallion. I see Manav's picture here, and you know, so that he co-founded that along with his brother Rajiv. He's also been associated in as a faculty in almost every self-respecting institution in Kerala, right from IIM Kozhikode to virtually every major business school. He's also served on the board of Kerala Venture Capital Fund and continuing to be associated with KSIDC and various other associations. He is virtually the founder president of many, many associations here, the Indian Society for Training and Development, the Thai Kerala, and several other very actively involved past president and assistant governor in Rotary. And from a KMA perspective, the only living past president who served twice. And I think in the last 50 years, there has been only one SR who's served as president twice and continuing to, despite having stepped down probably a decade ago from his presidentship, he still continues to be a very, very pivotal partner and guide for KMA. I think, SR, I've already gone overboard. He's not going to be happy that I have said so much. This is a problem when you start talking about people who are close to you. So I'll stop with a very formal welcome. Over to you, SR. Sorry, before that, let me invite our president. Since I heard him first, I thought he's, but that was, we only heard a minute from him. We should certainly hear a little more from Madhav about KMA, about the plans and projects of KMA, and also about what he has in store for us in the next few months ahead. Presidential address by Madhav.
Thank you, Vivek. I don't think there is any need for a presidential address as an address here. You've already done the briefing as far as concerned. Thank you so much for making this happen, is what I would say. It's a very difficult time for all of us, challenging times. We can't plan anything. We can't define anything in advance. It's all planning for that particular day and implementing it like that. For example, I was in a meeting right now and planning for a registration tomorrow morning. That's when I wanted to comment on what you're asking about lockdown and all. I heard just now that registration offices are closed for 10 days from tomorrow. So that's it. So these are all hints of what is in store for each one of us. You can't plan anything. And as far as management education program is concerned, we have been planning a series of programs from the very beginning since we started this year in November. We had been working out different curriculum on continuous programs, monthly ones programs, and a full certification program actually conceived and kept ready, but we didn't have the time and the kind of direction actually on how to implement that in these kind of conditions. So that is when we thought this can't go on like this. There has to be some positivity which has to be induced in our executives and managers and the entrepreneurs. And that is when SR, in his own real way, he said that let us start with the program. I will do it. Let us at least guide our youngsters and the managers and those who would like to know more about how to make things happier, how to feel yourself satisfied in what they are doing. I've got something which I read in a book which is called Ikigai, written by Francis Mirachus, that's how it's pronounced, I guess, and Hector Garcia. And he said this book and a program which he is conceiving can change the mindset of many of our people to become more productive. I thought, what more can you expect in these tough times? And from a person who's as positive and as exciting and with extra energy like SR, he himself only can do that. So here we are for this first program. I would call it Executive Development Program. This is just one of the many kind of events which we are planning for the rest of the year. We will definitely do more of this based on this kind of a positive response which we got from each one of you present here. So without much ado, let me hand it over to our faculty for the day, our own past president, senior member of KMA, SR Nair. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhav. Thank you, Vivek. In fact, it is such a chummel listening to people saying encomium about things. I always make it a very, very conscious effort to dissuade all those introducers to introduce me. Actually, wherever possible, I try to do that. But with Vivek sitting so far away, I couldn't do that. And Vivek is chip of the old block. He opens and he the Saraswati starts from there, actually. So it is simply not possible to actually stop Vivek when he's on his elements and when he's on his floor. I must thank you at the same time, holding the same chamal, Vivek. I thank you for the introduction. But next time, don't repeat it. Okay. All right. My dear friends, I see fairly varied people from varied vocations, varied age parameters, and also people who are entrepreneurs, people who are senior managers, people who are part of business, etc. And lately, I just see Bibu having joined. Thank you, Bibu. Now, see, as President Madhav had said, we have been endeavoring to do this executive development program in KMA, which actually had been a KMA's one of the very serious activities of KMA all through those years. Because of COVID, we have not been able to do it, because many times when you do the training, the physicality is always counted. And when you do the training on Zoom and Google platforms, with the webinar fatigue that all of us are in, and because all of us are most of you are doing the job from the home on the same medium, so you would like to get away from this horrible thing rather than being pulled into in the form of a training or something. You will not like it, but there is no other option. And as you had seen, and I think all of us are insofar if you really look at it over the last year and 3 months. I would rather term this month as the toughest of all the months that we had gone through. In fact, if you really look back and look at the lockdown that is declared by the Prime Minister and by the Chief Minister, and later by the Prime Minister for Kerala and India, you will see that those were all simple things. You know, the numbers were 10 and 15 and 30 and 40. Here we are talking about a particular city and a district even exceeding in terms of 5,000, 2,000 in Mumbai, in Delhi, going to lakhs of numbers. So such a horrendous time that all of us are going through, such a depressive news that we all of us are hearing, and it is augmented by the media and social media. Media means including social media. You can't open a newspaper in the morning. You can't actually look at the TV these days in the morning. You can't look at the news, and you definitely cannot open your social media, because all that comes to you is those pitiable photographs and snaps of people suffering, gasping for breath, and dead bodies being cuttered, I mean, taken away in numbers in all this. I think we have to have a reprieve from all these things. Probably, I don't know, but I don't guarantee, but I will try. I always try. Many things I have tried. So this also, I will try. Guarantee. The outcome of this is unto you, because whatever we are going to do is predominantly intellectual in nature rather than doing anything physically. So welcome you all. I know that afternoon sessions are not a very entertaining sessions. Afternoon sessions are also not that it's a siesta time mostly that we come across, but then please bear with us for having held it in the afternoon. We'll try to finish off as fast as possible, but I will try to see that it is more interesting and more thought-provoking. That is what my endeavor will be. Prajit, share screen. Am I allowed to share screen?
Yes, sir. You can.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Am I audible, and is my presentation seeable, Vivek? Or
yes,
right? Thank you.
Yes.
Madhav, thank you. Yeah. It is. Madhav had actually said who are the authors and what is the book, etc. It is actually called. It's a pronunciation of this is called GAI is pronounced as Guy, GUI. Okay, and IKI is pronounced as Iki. So how do you pronounce this? In Japanese, it's Ikigai. It's not Ikigai, it's Ikigai. That's what it is. Anyway, these are all common names, so we can use, having had this become a book, we could pronounce it the way we want to. And most of the nations, you'll see the pronunciations always vary. So this is, otherwise, if you want to pronounce it correct, like, you know, I have this challenge of pronouncing entrepreneur, because it's a French word, and it in English, people call this entrepreneur. Okay, so similar to that is this one. So, but the right Japanese pronunciation of this is Ikigai. Okay. Now, this is all about a reason for being. There is an equivalent French word, which is called raison d'être. Okay. It is written as RAISONDETRE. It's actually pronounced, it's written in a way, we'll have to read it like raison d'être, whereas it is pronounced in French as raison d'être. Both are absolutely same meaning. And in English, you say the reason for being, the reason for being, the reason for living. It is beyond all those materialistic things that we had acquired. It is beyond those esteem needs that we have reached. It is beyond those actualizing that we do. And it is about what is the purpose and meaning of your existence. So it actually asks you, what is the purpose and meaning of your existence? So from a perspective, if you look at it, this is more about us training or telling or cajoling our mind to find out the appropriate vocation and the appropriate living style where we can elicit or we can derive the maximum happiness or maximum satisfaction or delivering maximum meaning or significance and meaning for our existence. And that is actually Ikigai is all about. I'm not going to, while I will take some excerpts from the book to for your purpose, I'm actually going to try to look at it from a different perspective. So, and normally I'm considered to be a viduvayan and a loud mouth. Okay, viduvayan because whatever comes to my mouth, I speak. A loud mouth because I am a very, very high sounding, how high decibel person. So many people used to tell that for Rajmohan Nair and S.R. Nair, there is no mic required. So because we are loud by ourselves, you know, my past president Shastri used to tell me that I'm a diesel engine making a lot of noise. Okay, so this is the way things go. What I will do now is to take you through some questions. Okay, now the questions, if you have a piece of paper or a pen or if you have your mobile phone with where you can actually make a note or a laptop in front of you, I'm going to put about 10 questions in front of you. Okay. And there are three scenarios listed. And most of the scenarios are seldom or sometimes or often. That is what the scenarios that you will see there. Okay. One second. Please move this window from the share. I don't know. Are you also seeing this particular thing? Or please move this window from here from the share.
Yes, sir.
How does that happen? It has gone away, but it keeps reappearing. Prajit, any specific technical advice to remove that?
Sir, can you stop sharing and try again?
Okay, I'll try that. Okay. Am I visible? Vivek?
Yes.
Yeah, only Vivek and Rajmohan on the screen for me.
Yes.
Right. Okay, right. So Ikigai, the reason for being. So let me put this question. If you have a pen or a paper or a laptop or even your mobile phone, you can say just like that. So my first question to you is this one. Just reflect yourself and see. It says, I share my feelings with my close friends or relatives. It could be your spouse, it could be a wife, it could be a children, it could be a best friend, all this. So first word is seldom, that is I don't. Second one is sometimes. Yeah. Most of us are sometimes people actually. We try to stay in the middle. And the last one is called very often. I very often share my feelings to my close friends, or I sometimes share, or I seldom, I don't share. That's the meaning. If you are done with that, can I go to the next question, please? Okay, just take a piece of paper and put question one, whatever, very often, you can, or seldom, or sometimes. Okay, if you have done that, I'm going a little slowly. Okay, the second one is, I do kind things to others. Now, it is not chest thumping. It is not thumping your chest and do that, I do kind things to others. That's what the politicians do. Yeah, it is that somebody asked you a way, you told them how to go. Or you went somewhere and said, get me a glass of water. You ventured to go and get it. Or you were in the bus and you saw an old lady who had got in. You got up and asked her to sit down. Or you were in the traffic junction, a lady came and asked her, will you give me some money? And you gave it up. Or somebody wanted to help you to cross the road. Or somebody wanted to take you to the place. Somebody wanted to give you an address and they take you to the place. So many, many small, kutty-kutty things. You know? I'm not saying those chest-thumping things about, I had given oxygen concentrated to Prime Minister Modi. So that my photo has gone. I'm not seeing that. I'm saying, do you personally do kind things to others? So the answer could be seldom or sometimes I do or very often. If you have checked on that, I'm going to the third question. The third question is, I spend more than 2 hours on social media per day. Because the important element here is not social media. The important element here is socializing on the media. Please understand. Now you may come to the social media, so you may come to WhatsApp, you may come to Insta, you may come to FB, or you may go to Twitter, you may go to LinkedIn, etc. Okay, but are you socializing on the media is a question, that the intent of this question, and you could answer whether it is seldom or whether it is sometimes, whether it is often. So let's go to the fourth question. That's all right with you. The fourth question is, I do at least 30 minutes of physical exercise every day. It could be walking, it could be games that you do, that is, you know, participating in shuttle, badminton, tennis, or golf, or even doing physical work, physical exertion, or doing yoga, or doing those breathing and yoga put together. That is sparing 10 minutes for your body. Okay. And some people don't have to do that because they may be doing a lot of physical work themselves. But at least that also is part of the physical exercises that you do. Just pick on this and find out whether you do it seldom, whether you do it sometimes, or whether you do it very often. If you ask me, over the last 1.5 months, mine is seldom, actually. Otherwise, I was a regular walker every day. But last 30, 35 days, I have not been walking at all. So I go into the seldom parameter now. Otherwise, I used to be on the very often level. The fifth one to you is this. I know my strengths and I use them to improve the quality of my life. Okay. Yeah, this is a question many people will say, I really don't know what my strengths are. And quite possible, very possible that, are, I don't know, mere ko malum nahi hai. Main janta nahi hu, or enik aari illa. Because enda strength and that's a possibility. That is a very much a possibility. Or the second one is, I know what my strengths are, but I don't use. Okay. And the third one is, I know and I use them. So which is that you would like to pick it? I think that is what my strengths are. I'm a good communicator. My strengths are communication and I do it often. Okay. Or I'm a good guide, or I'm a good mentor. I mentor people and I do it often. I have good mentoring skills. I do it often. So there are the strengths. Or I am a good analytical person. I can analyze things and I use my strength often. Or I don't even know what my strengths are. If you have ticked these five, all the five, I hope you are doing this exercise. I'm going to the sixth one. The sixth one is that I find a deep sense of fulfillment by using my strength and my skills. Okay. Now, you may do it as a part of your vocation. But if your vocation, your job is something else, but you're still using this strength elsewhere, you know. Yeah, sometimes people like me use this strength in my hobby and in my extracurricular more than in my job and vocation. Possible, quite possible. But the thing is, I find a deep sense of fulfillment by using my strength and skills. Okay. If it was me, I would say, yes, I mentored this guy so, and he has got punch and he has reached places. So I find a deep sense of a fulfillment by doing so. Okay. Or if it is Vivek, he says he's an extreme analytical and communication skill. Let's say Vivek says that I use my strength and I have helped people. And by doing so, I have been able to get a fulfillment. Something like that. Okay. Or if maybe since only Rajmohan's face is on the screen, so I have also used Rajmohan. See that I helped somebody.
Yes, sir, I am here.
Yeah, ensuring his life. Ensuring his life continuity. And I find a sense of fulfillment by using my strength and skills. Okay, something like that. Okay. So if you have picked that, if you have picked your choice there, I'll go to the seventh one. Okay. The seventh one says, I engage in activities that I find challenging and enjoy. I know it's a very tough question. Many of us want to be doing very absorbing and challenging things, but that is not part of our job. Many of us, lots of us will realize it because my job is very mundane, where my job is very transient, my job is clerical, my job is repetitive, my job is to listen to my boss and do whatever I say, my job is walking, my job is taking things on my head and going, but then that is not a challenging thing, but I need to do that, but I am also able to find some activities where I can. It may be extracurricular, it may be off the job, it may be something else that is actually not part of your vocation, that is job, but you still do. So do you engage in activities that you find challenging and you find absorbing? Challenging means yes, it actually stretches you. Challenging is a very positive word, it is not a negative word. Many people use the word problem. In fact, most of the positive type people tell you that never use the word problem and always use the word challenge, because challenge is a very positive word. Because if it is a challenge, it is to be surmounted. If it is to be overcome, etc. Okay, yeah, that is so. Do you engage in activities that you find challenging and absorbing? Absorbing means for hours together you could do it with the same level of energy, with the same level of concentration, and with the same level of focus. That is what it is. So do you do that? And if you do that, you say very often. If you don't do, you say sometime. And if otherwise, you can say seldom. That is, you don't do it. So this is another question, which is, I have a sense, I have a feeling of gratitude towards people and events of my past. Personally speaking, if you ask me, you know, whenever I think of my past, I am not very happy. You know, I get very depressed. My thinking becomes very black and white when I think of my past. So therefore, if this person comes to me, I say I seldom feel of my, not gratitude, but I don't even want to think of the events of my life in the past. Some people, when they look back and say that, okay, the teacher who taught you, the uncle who took you to the job, or somebody else who taught you a skill, somebody else who coached you, some event in life which had actually given you a complete change of moment, etc. And do you actually remember those with a sense of gratitude is the question. If that such a thing has happened or such a thing had been there, you can put very often, or if it is sometimes happening, you can put sometime, or you can put seldom. Okay. Let me go to the ninth question, which is a penultimate question. And the question is a very simple question. And this question is very relevant now. Because lots of us feel that with COVID, we don't know what's going to happen. Okay, that is what we see. But in spite of the COVIDs of the life, in spite of the COVIDs that we come across, are you optimistic about the future? That is, ask yourself, am I optimistic about my future? And if you feel so, and if you feel so often, go into often case, if you feel some time, or if you feel very depressed, you take the first. Okay. And therefore, my dear friends, I come to the last question. The last question is this. I do feel that my life is meaningful and it has a quality of purpose. Now, this is actually a sort of a peak question. Some of you are very young people. Some of you are people who have almost come to the stage of actualizing. Some of you are sort of retired and leading still peaceful life. Some of my very young friends know, I see Malav here, I see Akshara here, I see people who are very young people for whom the life and career are just started, you know. So they may find it difficult to fathom this question. But he says that I do feel that my life is meaningful and it has a quality of purpose. If you feel so, put it, and if you feel so sometimes, take the middle. If you feel it often, go to the right side. If you don't feel it is meaningful, you can put it. Okay. Friends, I have requested you, because this is not a workshop, but it has become a little similar to a workshop, where I have told you to tick. Now, I will tell you this. Okay. It's a very simple thing. My idea here is not to give you any big formulas and try to do calculations and etc. My idea is to make you start thinking. So these statements that I put before you, for you to start thinking and then reflecting and then thinking whether you have done it or not. That is it. So it is not, you're not going to tell me the answer. You're not going to tell anyone answers that you have ticked to others, because we are in a Zoom. It is not necessary that you do that. But I'm going to give you some markings, some marks. You start applying it. Okay. So if everyone, part of this group, who had actually ticked seldom, okay, seldom, or the first option, okay, give it a zero mark. All right. It's a very simple statement. And if everyone who had took some time, okay, some time, you give it a two mark. And if all of you who have put very often, and there is in one or two questions, it is not obvious. Once it says, I know, that's the last option. Okay. All of you where you have put the last option, you put four marks. So my dear friends, when you do your computing, now you can stack it up together, you can add it up together. Okay. So what is the mark possibility? The mark possibility is between 0 and 40. At the highest, isn't it, Vivek? Simple arithmetic. At the highest, you must be getting 40 marks. At the lowest, you must be getting 0 marks, or you must be somewhere in between. Okay. If it is all the middle, you must be getting 20 marks, or it cannot be that way. I'm sure you may have some variations here and there and all. Okay. So now, those of you who want to comment, okay, you can. I'll just, for the time being, go off my screen. Just to look at maybe some feedback from you. How many of you had actually got 40?
Yeah.
Okay. So anyone with, okay, 40? No, 40. Okay. I'm sure nobody is there with zero as well. I'm sure. Nobody will tell me that I have a zero. I'm 100% sure of that. Okay. So tell me, those of you, I can raise your hand. Maybe that pictorially you can raise your hand, or you can even come alive and say that, yeah, yes, I have scored somewhere about between 30 and 40. How many of you have scored between 30 and 40? Can somebody raise your hand like this? Good. Madhav, okay, very good. You, true leader, okay. Then, GBG, George Verghese, very good. Okay, who else?
I have only 30.
So you could raise your hand, don't worry, because I said 30 and 40, you know.
Sir, Rajesh,
Dinesh Kinnayar,
okay,
very good, Dinesh
Kinnayar.
Yeah, very good, Dinesh Kinnayar, good.
I got 32.
Yeah, Anupama, you also are. Oh, you, Anupama, okay. Now, how many of you are somewhere between 25 and 30? 25 and 30, Vivek, okay. Right, Anil Verma, okay, then. Should I go to the chat mode, because I get a lot of chat answers. Okay, chat. To Ashwin Sabu, 32, great. Vinod Chandran, Vinod, 26. Rajesh Kumar, 28. Okay, good. So some good score. Okay, now, I'm not going to ask those of you who have scored less than 22, raise your hand. Okay, I'm not going to ask those of you who had actually scored less than 22, raise your hand. But I would like you to think that why it has come to that level. See, this is not a question based on which you are going to be penalized or prosecuted or directed or guided. This is a question, these are simple statements put before you just to see that, you know, how you actually, you know, whether you are actualizing yourself, whether you are enjoying whatever you do yourself. And it was a very simple questionnaire, because the last questions were all about actualizing. The middle answers were all about somewhere in the middle, and the first options were all the negative. Okay, so I will leave it at that, but I would definitely want you to think that how much have you scored, and maybe you can go back to it and see. If anyone wants this presentation of mine, you could contact our executive director Jojo. He will send it to you. So because I normally don't keep any IP right on any of my presentations, so no problems at all. I can, so that these questions can come to you, no issues at all. Okay, let's go. Let me share screen again and go to my presentation. Thank you. Okay, again, I only have screen right now. Since I've gone with this, I have screen of Vivek and Radhwan. Vivek, are you enjoying, or you're okay? Radhwan, is it okay? Right. So if some of you, some of you are finding it okay, you can chat, you can send the chat to me so I can see that accordingly. Now let me keep going. Okay. This is already done. Now let me introduce you to a very great counselor, psychologist, a very well-known person. His name is Abraham Maslow. Most of you who have done your MBA, most of you who have done your MBA would have studied it. Most of you who have studied psychology have studied it. Those of you who have done engineering may not have heard of him. Those of you who have done normal arts and science courses may not have heard of him. Okay. Abraham Maslow had a major role in collating the human needs and wants into category, because human needs and wants are multiple and it is eternal. But what he did is, he did a research, he studied people, talked to people and studied research. He put things in perspective. He put things in perspective. By the way, my communication is okay. I'm mostly using English. My communication is okay, right? Okay. And if any challenge you face, please chat me. Okay. Send me the chat. All right. Now, I'm putting this in front of you. This is what it is. This is called Abraham Maslow's need hierarchy theory. Need hierarchy theory. I will take some time to explain it because it's very important for all of us to know. Okay. The first is, you know, this is called a pyramid. It's called a need hierarchy theory pyramid. You understand, need means the wants that we have, the requirements. Hierarchy means there must be some gradation, and theory means it's actually a postulation. So it's a need hierarchy theory. We will start from the bottom. There are, see, if you really look at it, my understanding is that the world population is close to 800 crore people, which is 80 billion people, the world population as of now. Indian population is very close to 1.4 billion people. Chinese population is something close to about 1.45 billion people. And we are very soon expected to overtake China as far as the population is concerned. Okay. And with between China and India, when we come into, we actually hold close to about 30% of the world population within ours. And there are other populous countries as well, like Pakistan, Bangladesh, etc. Okay. The question, we are not here to learn the demography. Let's understand it. But why I said about this 800 crore people or 8 billion people is that if you really look at the bottom need, the need at the bottom, okay, which is called physiological need or primary needs, a man's primary need. And there are many, many movies and novels and theories, etc., that have been propagated based on that. And that we call this primary need, roti, kapda, or makan. That's what they call it, food, shelter, and clothing. Okay. Food, shelter, and clothing. Okay. Now, if you really look at it, my dear friends, out of this 800 crore people, there are hundreds of crores of people amongst us who still have not crossed to this need to go to the next grade account. Please understand. And that is a very pitiable sense of affairs as far as the world is concerned. Okay. That is why it is at the bottom of the pyramid. A vast majority of the population of the world has not been able to cross their basic requirement of meeting, okay, food, shelter, and clothing. And please understand, as per Abraham Maslow, only after your needs on all these three are met that you go to the next need. And the next need is called the need for safety. You want to be safe. You want to be secure. You don't want to get killed by a running truck, or you don't want the tufan to come and the tornado to come and follow you. So you want to be safe, okay? You want to protect yourself. You want to protect your near and dear. So that is called the safety needs, security needs, okay? Now, only after anybody who crosses their primary need that they can reach you, okay? And you also see, because it is a pyramid, okay, there are hundreds of crores of people who haven't crossed this need. What you need to understand is that there are hundreds of crores of people who have actually been dying without meeting either the primary need or the secondary need in their life. How pitiable is that? And we call ourselves humanity, like the Homo sapiens and humanity. And amongst that, hundreds of crores of people who have not been able to move up from their primary needs and security. And Abraham Maslow now says, those who cross the safety needs come to something called social or psychological needs, which is to love and to be loved. To love and to be loved. Okay. So you have met your roti, kapda, makan. You have met your safety and security need. And then you come to a need where you need to be loved. You need to belong to. You may be part of Rotary. You may be part of a family. You may be part of a group. You may be part of an association. Or you may be part of a community. You may be part of a society. So need of to love and to be loved. And please understand, hundreds of crores of people here also don't cross this need. Beyond that, they may not have gone. Okay, many would not have reached here at all, and many would not have crossed here at all. Okay, and then we go to something called esteem needs. And as you see, the pyramid closing up, the numbers closing up. And what is esteem mean? You want to be recognized, you want to be awarded, you want to be rewarded, you want to be incentivized, you want to be made as the president of AMA, you want to become the president of your club, you want to become the president of your association, you wanted to be at the podium being recognized by a chief minister, these, that, etc. And because of the social media revolution, evolution, and later the revolution, lots of us actually resort to that to be reckoned, isn't it? Lots of us go there to be reckoned. So you must, you know, you must have just passed your 10th, your daughter must have passed your 10th exam with all A1. You put it up there, you know, A1, so and so. You get a certificate, you put it up there in the social media so that you get what? You get this. Sometimes, okay, you get this. What is that? That is actually meeting your esteem needs. That is awards, rewards, incentives, and recognition. Okay, that is your esteem. And as the numbers close up, okay, maybe there are crores of people, but it is not in hundreds of crores of people. And thereafter, only after meeting your esteem need that you go up to the next need, that is actually called self-actualization. Now, many people give different answers to this, okay, because it all depends upon who is giving you the answer. I always take this as self-actualization is a phase that you reach after meeting your four needs where you enjoy what you do. So self-actualization is enjoying what you do. Okay. And that could be meeting up your potential. That could be opening up your talent and reserves, etc., etc. But there you are seeing some fulfillment. What is a fulfillment? You're enjoying yourself. And while enjoying yourself, you get two things. What is that? First is already there. Enjoying in between. Joy. You get the joy. You get the happiness. You get anandam. You get anandam. Some people even go up to the level of bliss. Right? You know, blessed bliss. You know, they're feeling eternally happy doing what they're doing. Okay. That is a... Now, along with that, 100% guaranteed, peace descent down on you. Peace. Samadhan. Now, while young people sitting in front of me on seeing the screen may find little difference of opinion or may not have reached there, they may think that, okay, it is not peace and happiness. It is also money. It is also position. It is also salary. It is also materials. It is also speeding cars. It is also jacuzzi in the bathroom. It is also this. It is also that. I don't deny. But as you grow up in life, as you move forward in your age, okay, as you pass through various phases of your being, you will come to a place where you will want to enjoy what you're doing. But do you get to reach there? Very seldom. Among 800 million population, actually 800 crore population, that is 8 billion population, not even 7 billion wouldn't have reached anywhere near this. Doing the self-actualization, doing the happiness of doing what you're doing. Okay. Now let me take you to Abraham Maslow. After having revealed this as a sort of a postulation or a theory, took another 10 years to come out with one more, which most of even I had seen, you know, even B schools, they don't teach that. B school teaches this because they want people to reach out there. But I have not seen this in the business schools. I have seen in some psychology sessions, classes, etc. But this is something that I'm taking to the next edition of that is a postulation that he made 10 years after he actually came out with the need hierarchy theory. And this is this. So this has actually, he put this only 10 years later to his first one. And he called it self-transcendence. And it is called beyond self. My dear friends, this triangle is put by me. Actually, the triangle should have been very small. Very, very small. I put the triangle because I wanted to incorporate the sentence inside that, self-transcendence. So please don't think that the area of the triangle is that big. No, the area of the triangle is right on the tip of the pyramid. Right on the tip of the pyramid. Very little area, very little volume. Okay. People who are reaching the level of self-transcendence, making oneself available to others. How many of the 50 people sitting in front of me can say that, okay, I am at that stage now. I have gone through all my stages of primary needs, the need to be secured, the need to be loved, the need to be awarded, rewarded, and the need to enjoy. Beyond that, how many of you can go happily say that I am making myself available to others? And how many examples that come before you to say that, yes, I realize this is the person who said, yes, I am available to others? How many state leaders, how many political heads, how many leaders of community, how many leaders of religions, how many leaders of caste and creed and associations and organizations, etc., had come to this level and say that I am available for you. Use me. Transcending myself, and I'm saying it is beyond self. I'm not looking at me at all. I'm making myself available to you. So this is actually the theory of need hierarchy. And needless to say that only at the last two triangles, though I have already told you, the triangle that I put self-transcendence is a very small area triangle or small volume pyramid. Pyramid is a volumetric, triangle is an area one. So it's a small area triangle or a small volume pyramid, which is very little number. And those people would be, you can count them on your fingertips. Those people who can count them on your fingertips, feeling that he have reached the level of making himself available to others. But let me tell you this, the sort of happiness and joy, the sort of purpose and significance, the sort of meaning that you derive at this position is beyond words. I can't describe that. Okay, one has to go through that to feel that actually. And how many of us that we know in such position, it is something that we are yet to identify, yet to see. Okay, now, hopefully, I hope you're all okay so far, insofar that we had gone through this. Okay, let me take you to the next one. So we are now trying to go through the Abraham Maslow's theory of need, also about the self-transcendence. Okay. And if you want a direction or a guidance, I would exhort some of you to reach up this self-transcendence level. You could. Now, I'm not saying that you should behave like Gautam Buddha, leave your wife and kid and go for penance and then come back as a manhood Buddha, okay, the learned. I'm not saying that. But there is a possibility in some of you sitting in front of me to reach the position of self-transcendence. And I am only saying that there is something called the self-transcendence stage in your life, and I am exhorting you, please reach there. It is actually beyond ananda, beyond happiness. Okay, back to this one, back to our lesson. Okay, so what does it say? You discover who you are by acting naturally. This is a problem that we face. Just look around you. Is there anyone who is behaving naturally around you? Seldom you will see people. Very seldom you will see people. You see imitators. You see pretenders. Okay. You see, I know people. Okay. And none of them actually act naturally. Okay. They go by role models. They go by what they see. And they behave in the manner that they have seen others behaving. But how many of us actually can say that, okay, by discovering yourself, by acting naturally? So it is actually saying, what is it? Being yourself. Acting naturally means being yourself. And that is ikigai. That is raison d'etre. Being yourself is raison d'etre. Okay, let us go to the next one. Okay, before I go to the ikigai thing, let me also take you to this one. This is actually all of you sitting in the room, I know that many of you may not be endorsing to a particular sex or particular dharma's concepts or philosophies. I put this before you just to explain a thing. Okay, it is not to explain things to you in a religious frame of mind or framework, or in a community framework. I am placing this about my learning from a Upanishad called Taittiriya Upanishad, actually. Okay, Taittiriya Upanishad. And where I was extremely fascinated by this. In fact, in the book that I have written called Shubhayatra, I had actually spent one article full for this alone. Okay. Now, what I meant here is, it is for us to understand. Okay. The Upanishad says, Okay, so please go with an open mind. Don't think that it's a Hindu philosophy or a Buddhist philosophy or a Jatiya philosophy. Or you just say that, okay, what is the learning from this? Please go by this. And it describes, says that, okay, you have three shariras and five koshas. Kosha also can be said as the kosha. In Malayalam, we say kosham. Okay, kosham means cell. Here I use the word sheet. Layer, one layer, another layer, third layer, fourth layer. So I just use the kosha here from a layer meaning. Okay. So it says you have three shariras and five koshas. And three shariras are sthula sharira, sukshma sharira, and karana sharira. Okay. Now, sthula sharira means your gross body, that 65 kilos of you, or that 100 kilos of you, or that 45 kilos of you. Okay. That is your sthula sharira. And people, you know what they say? What you eat is what you become. That's what they say. You know, what you eat is what you become. So you eat plenty, you take all the proteins, you take all the fat, and you actually become a very, very, very obese person. So instead of sthula, it will be a little larger sthula. Okay, but it is actually called the gross body. So your body is what is sthula sharira. So out of three sharira, one is called the sthula sharira, which is your body. And your body is what you eat, okay, what you consume. Okay. The next one is called sukshma sharira. Sukshma, okay, that means subtle. You know, it could be having a meaning of minute also, subtle, okay. And here we have, okay, so the sthula sharira, as I've told you, the body, it is from annam, from the food. So it is called annamaya kosha. So now, in the place of Rajmohan Nair and Vivek, I see Balakrishnan's photograph and Sariga live, okay. Because it is only three people can visit scene. One is me, one is Bala's lovely photograph, and there is ever smiling Sarika there actually. So that is a happiness. Okay. It is always a pleasure presenting in front of people like Sarika, because you get overjoyed doing that actually. Thank you. Now, let me say Annamaya Kosha. You know, you eat Annam, the food that you eat. Okay. And that makes your body. What you eat is your body. The second sharira is called sukshma sharira, very subtle body, which is, if you want to explain this, it is called your pranamaya kosha, the breath that you make. Actually, today it is more prevalent, it is more pronounced actually. Today there are so many people dying for breath actually, around the country, across the country. So now you look at it. You have taken all the best medicines, all the best foods, all those things, but you're gasping for breath actually. By simply gasping for breath, you're dying. Okay, you're good. Why? Because your pranamaya kosha actually is getting deteriorated. Okay, your sukshma sharira, the prana that goes into you actually is not coming. When the prana is not coming, you're dying. Now, suddenly everyone looks at the importance of oxygen and prana. Okay. But it has been there in almost all religions. You know, personally, I had gone through a very, very large scale learning of Vipassana meditation by the Buddhist, this thing where you can't speak for about 11 days. So can you imagine SRNA like a person not uttering even a single word for 11 days? And I went for this meditation training, and I came back by about 10 kg less. Okay. Because they gave the food only by 6:30 breakfast, by 11 lunch, nothing else, and no speaking. And they said, you can't even look at the other's eyes. You can't even look at the other's eyes because you're communicating. So you keep your eyes closed. Okay. And from 4:30 in the morning till 9:30 in the night, you do tapas. You do your meditation. I had undergone that. Actually, it's a fantastic experience. If any one of you want any reference of that, I can personally recommend that. At the same time, there are many other meditations. Today, there are meditations made up on religions. There are meditations made up of caste. There are meditations made up of people. There are meditations made. There are patented meditations. Please understand. There are patented meditations by people. But let us all leave it aside. Let us understand meditation that you do in whichever form that you do. Even I would call you sitting 20 minutes or 30 minutes, okay, without thinking and just sitting like this, it's a piece of meditation, okay, so no problems on that. But the fact is, okay, your pranamaya kosha, that is a pranayama that you do, or as a part of the meditation that you do, okay, is very, very critical and very vital. Okay, so first part of your subtle body is your prana. Second part of your subtle body is your mind, which is called manonmaya kosha. Manonmaya kosha. So there's a third sheath. So first sheath is annamaya kosha. Uske andar kya hai? Pranamaya kosha. Inside that what? Mind. And all of you will know, people who have meditated will tell you, mind and prana is directly related. Okay. You actually reach your meditation by concentrating on your prana, on your breath. Okay. On your breath. Okay. So your subtle body, okay, your subtle body is of three sheets. First sheet being prana, the oxygen. Second sheet is the mind. Okay. No control. Particularly people of our age. It is suddenly, you know, it travels beyond speed of light. Speed of light is what is defined till now. Okay. Beyond speed of light, people don't know. They say there are torques and there are neutrinos which travels even beyond the speed of light. We don't know. But please understand, mind is one such thing. It can travel from anywhere to anywhere in that micro, milli, whatever second, nanoseconds that you have. Okay. And inside that is your intellect, which is called Vijnana Maya Kosha. So you have three sheets, okay, in one sharira, and that is subtle body, which is a sukshma sharira, contains your breath, your mind, and your intellect. Okay, now the third sharira, and this is beautifully they have defined it. The third sharira is the reason for your being. Karanam, the karanam for your being. It is that sharira which is reason for yourself. That is called Anandamaya Kosha. So if I have explained to you Abraham Maslow's theory of hierarchy, need hierarchy, or if I have actually made you go through that small test that you have done, all that which you really look at it, you'll see that the ultimate thing in life is that happiness that you derive, the joy that you derive, the ananda that you derive, the bliss that you undergo. Okay. And yes, of course, it will be more pronounced as you go through your ages, as you go through your living. Okay. Because in the early stages, we are not really bothered about we are breathing because we are breathing. We are not really bothered with we are growing because we are growing. We are not really bothered our mind is working because it is working. Okay. Because we are not bothered the intellect is it is happening. But you reach certain stages of your life where you live that all that you have done, all that has become that has been the reason, the cause for your being so. That is called Karana Sharira. So that is what Taittiriya Upanishad actually defines a body of three Shariras and five sheets. Three Shariras means the Stula Sharira, that is your gross body, the Sukshma Sharira, that is a subtle body, which is actually the unseeable prana, mind, and intellect, unseeable. Okay. And the reason body, the cause body, that is the reason for your happiness. Okay. And as you go through this, you reach there. Okay. That is what the Upanishad says. This is also, I'm just putting it before you just to understand that, okay, people realize there are ways to reach. Okay. If Abraham Maslow tell us that, okay, after this and after this and after this, you reach. Okay. Somebody else says that, okay, you eat and you breathe, you think, and you reason out, and therefore you are. Okay. So it is not only your body, and you reach there because you reason it, you become cause of it. Okay. That is actually as far as three bodies and five sheets are concerned. So you must be really wondering, this guy S.R. Nair, he said it is Ikigai. He hasn't even uttered one single word about it, and he has been taking us through all these absolute nonsenses, and it is more than 1 hour that has passed by him doing this nonsense. Sorry for that. We are slowly reaching there. I hope you are enjoying. I hope all of you are enjoying. Let me hope so. Okay. Now, what is Ikigai? What is Ikigai? Okay. Now, I will actually take certain excerpts from the book. I'm not going to speak about the author. That they have done wonderful thing. They have really innumerable contribution by even bringing out this book, etc. They're also saying examples. Okay. And in fact, they give the example of people in an island called Okinawa. Somebody who have read the book will know they're referring to people in the island called Okinawa. In the island called Okinawa, there are hundreds of people living beyond the age of 100. And very capable people. It is not their bedridden people. They go through their life, even at the age of 100, 101, 102, as a normal human being go through their life. So this is what actually they caught their attention. How can people of this island, or all of us are beyond 100, but behaving like superhuman beings, at the same time going through life as they have been, as you have seen with others. So that actually became very fascinating for them. And they started exploring as to what it is. And that is how they came about to their book called Ikigai. Okay, small brook, funny water. Thank you. So this is pronounced as Ikigai. It's a Japanese concept meaning the reason for being. I've already explained it. In French, they call it raison d'être. And in English, we call it the reason for being. Okay. And Ikigai. Everyone has their own Ikigai. So that is beautiful. So my Ikigai, Bala's Ikigai, Rajmohan Nayar's Ikigai, President Madhav's Ikigai, or people like there are their Akshara, Anupama, or George, or those people who are around us. It's different. Okay. But the challenge is to discover your Ikigai. That is where the problem. In fact, one of the questions it said, I know what my strengths are. And one of the answers that is given is that I don't know my strengths. There are plenty of us even today who really do not know what you are worth, what your strengths are. And you know, just diverting for about 2 minutes, there's a very famous social scientist called Howard Gardner. Okay, Howard Gardner, he must be about 80 years old now. He sits on a chair in Harvard Social School. Okay, and he has come out with a very high postulation after studying, researching longitudinally. When I say longitudinally, you research on the same person for a longer duration of time. So he went on studying people for 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, etc. And then by the end of it, in the late 80s or early 90s, he came out with this book called Multiple Intelligence, A Frame of Mind. If you're interested, you could read it. Okay. Now, Multiple Intelligence, A Frame of Mind. Now, let me put that before you, because Howard Gardner, after this 40 years of research in the book that he has come through, he says, lots of us, particularly we the parents, and there are, I see many young parents in front of me. Some of them are old too. Okay. They say that my only worry is my son must score some good marks. Okay. If he comes home with 80, you're feeling so bad, frustrated. 85 still could be better. 90, okay. 95, yes, there. And 98, yes. The boy comes home with 98. You know, what does the father ask? What happened to the 2 marks? What happened to the 2 marks? You know, the father is upset. He said, you've reached up here. 2 more marks. So, and it says, all this is based on the intelligence called IQ. It's called intelligence quotient. And what is the definition of intelligence quotient? It is easily determinable by your mental age divided by physical age into 100. That's a quotient. It tells you. And there's a famous society called Mensa, which is headquartered in London, MENSA, where they admit people only of IQ beyond 140. So they say our membership is reserved for 0.01% of the world population of people who are having high IQs. But in the process, what happens is we are all, most of us parents and most of us children and most of us are, at most of the qualifying examinations, whether it is UPSC, whether it is Staff Selection Commission, whether it is even private institutions, okay, we employ only this objective type of questions on IQ. It will ask you your problem solving skills, your analytical ability, and your memory. So when you combine your memory, your analytical skills, and your problem solving ability, you become best in IQ. Mama happy, Papa happy, all Kudumbam happy, because your son has come home with 100 marks. Okay. And that is IQ. Howard Gardner says IQ is just one of the 9 intelligences that human being have. But he also says these 9 intelligences are not divided as 1/9 and distributed in your body, intellect. And these 9 intelligences are: 1, visual intelligence, or it is called space oriented, spatial intelligence. Okay. The second is called verbal intelligence or linguistic intelligence. The third, of course, is mathematical, logical, or IQ. And the fourth is kinesthetic intelligence, bodily intelligence. So when Sachin Tendulkar scores 6 or IL Vijayan scores a wonderful goal, or Chitra Visheshwaran comes and dance in front of you, or those lovely, they're expressing their intelligence through your body. That is kinesthetic intelligence. Okay. Then there is something that we always kept as talent, as music, which he calls it the fifth intelligence. Okay. Then he says there are 2 social intelligences for human being. One is called interpersonal intelligence. The other is intrapersonal intelligence. Intra means within. And then he has 2 more intelligences that he says: natural intelligence or exploratory intelligence. And the last is called existential intelligence or philosophical intelligence. So he says, actually, these are the intelligences that human being possess. But unfortunately, this is not distributed 1/9, 1/9, 1/9 across. And he says, in most of the people, there are 3 dominant intelligences and 3 dormant intelligences and 3 intelligences in the middle. Okay. I had actually been doing this test on many people, more than 2000 tests that I must have conducted, mostly on school, that is plus 2 and students and school students or the high school students. And only very seldom that I had come across anybody who has shown very high intelligence in all or very low intelligence in all. Mostly what I had seen is 3 dominant, 3 dormant, and 3 middle level intelligence. Okay. Now, based on which you can select your studies, you can select your vocation so that you can enjoy what you're doing. And that is what the final output is all about. Why I said about this 9 intelligences, my dear friend, is to introduce you one particular intelligence called intrapersonal intelligence. Intrapersonal intelligence, I feel, is a very high level of intelligence. Intrapersonal intelligence is your ability to understand you. And very seldom that people try to understand themselves. Very seldom that we see people trying to discover themselves. Very seldom that people try to say, what makes me ticking? They don't do that. They go by what others say. The boss says you do this. The father says you do this. The husband says you do it. The grandfather says you do it. The society says you do it. The religion says you do it. 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 You don't do anything that other, you don't do anything that you want to do. And what you must do is what you want to do. And what you want to do comes out of what you discover you want to do. So you have to discover yourself. How do you discover yourself? Apply your intrapersonal intelligence, please. Discover yourself, please. You apply your intrapersonal intelligence. You look deep into you. Again, I'm going to introduce a person, again, not by religious sense. I've heard about him. I was very enamored by it. To be very honest with all of you, I don't approve any sage or seer or anybody. So I am actually very, very, in fact, to many of their philosophy, I am against. To some of them, I am neutral. Okay. But I want to refer to a person called Ramana Maharshi. This person is actually, he's a illiterate person. He hasn't read and write. He doesn't know. He did not learn to read and write and all. It is in a place called Arunachalam in Tamil Nadu that he lived. Okay. And later he shifted to Sadashiv Nagar, Parasochars in Bangalore. And in the end, he died of cancer at the age of something close to 90. But you know, this person was interesting from one perspective. That's what I want to say. Anybody who goes to him, he'll ask this question: who are you? So you say, I'm Sarika Jeevan. Okay. Then they'll ask, then he'll look at you and say, who are you? You feel upset, you know. Initially, particularly if you are a very highly materialistic person and not thinking in terms of the significance of life, etc., you will think, you know, my goodness, then if I am the one who had taken you there, that person looking at you, are mad? Why did you bring me here? This person is keeping on asking me, who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? What is wrong with him? So it is something like asking this question, why at you 5 times? I will give you a reason. Now, they say in physical things, you know, you have seen in your shop floor, a big portion of grease is lying on the shop floor, which shouldn't have been the grease, you know. So you ask why. So there, somebody said, that guy who was carrying it, he put it there. Okay. So you ask again, why? Why? So he says, yeah, he actually put it there purposely. Then he asked why he did not get that good appraisal. You understand? Then you ask again, why? He said, he has a problem with his boss. Okay, then you ask again, why? So you understand, you are actually going to the root of the problem by asking the question five times. You ask the question five times. Similarly, is here, this Ramana Maharshi, you go to, he say, who are you? He say, I am SR Nair. Oh, who are you? I am in the field of IT, computer. Oh, who are you? So you get either irritated or you get to see some revelations. Now it is up to you to find out whether you find out the revelations or you feel irritated. But the fact is, in intrapersonal intelligence, okay, if you actually learn about yourself, you actually understand the purpose of your living. So discovering the purpose of living is all about Ikigai. And in Ikigai, everybody has a different purpose of living. It is not my purpose of living equal to Bala's purpose of living is equal to Rajmohan's purpose of living or Madhav's purpose of living or Vivek's purpose of living or Bhaurasav's purpose of living. The purpose of living is different. So to discover the purpose of being, okay, is a critical element there. And that is what this book said all about. And they said the people of Okinawa somehow, okay, very naturally, they behave naturally, okay. And by behaving naturally, by being themselves, they have been able to understand themselves. So they live better, they live happier, they live peaceful, and they live for a long number of years. Very simple. So what is it? Naturally understanding yourself. It is not synthetically understanding yourself. Okay. By naturally understanding, discovering yourself, you can actually understand the purpose of living and live happily long. Okay. Third. The basis of Ikigai is not only to enrich your life, but also to enhance the lives of others. You know, again, I go back to this intrapersonal intelligence. When we studied in the school and colleges, you know, or even in our offices, there are people whom we will run into telling that, yeah, I have done like this. Have I done the right thing? You ask. In school and colleges, I had seen plenty of times. So this Muni type of a guy who sits there, the classmate, okay, but you go to him, like, yesterday I did this one, was it right? So this guy will say, no, you didn't do it right. So these are the people who have understood themselves better, okay? And therefore, when you understand yourself better, you understand others much better. So it is discovering yourself is discovering the universe around you. Discovering yourself is discovering your family around you. Discovering yourself is discovering the society around you, and discovering yourself, discovering all those things that is around you. That is the meaning of Ikigai. Going further, Ikigai is very useful in finding contentment in life. Very, very true. When you discover yourself, you find the purpose and you reach towards that, the meaning is there and the meaning is understood. Contentment automatically happens. There is no doubt about that. And the last part is you can have as many Ikigais as you like. Okay, throughout your life, maybe one after the other, or even multiple Ikigais actually. Multiple reasons, not only one reason. So you say, yeah, your one reason is you want to actually feed the poor. Another reason, you want to help others to grow up in life. So there could be two purposes, you know. Or you say that, okay, you would like to, your purpose in life is to see that, okay, you achieve this. And you say, while achieving this, I would like also to like achieve this. So recently at home, I was discussing with my wife. Okay, sorry for being a little anecdotal. Forgive me for that. Okay, actually, we husband and wife were together running a company. And both of us were finding it very difficult to run companies, actually. After being in entrepreneurship myself for 25 years, last 5 years, I started hating it. Okay. And the last 5 years, my wife also started hating it. In fact, my wife tells me that I started hating it from the very day that I had become an entrepreneur. Okay, that was the case. Now, that being the case, we somehow got out of it. Okay, in the sense that we got out of the active entrepreneurship. There are still some entrepreneurship that I do, active entrepreneurship. So my wife said, I'm going to something else. Okay, today, some of the examples you'll see, if you go to Rajmohan Nair's house, there's a huge mural sitting in there. So my wife went into drawing murals. My wife went into learning music. My wife went into so many other things. And she's so happy doing that. She's so happy doing that actually. And you know, she can sit there and draw this mural, which I find it is the most irritating thing to do, because you know, the mural painting is a very painful thing. Minute level of dots that you put on that canvas and tum 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 like that to do that to, and it's as if to look very natural and at the same time very muralistic. But that lady can do it 5 days, 5 hours, 6 hours, 7 hours, sit there and do that and feel very happy about it. Just, I'm sorry for me saying so, but I'm trying to be anecdotal because there cannot be a better example than your own example. That's what I felt about myself. Okay, somebody who has been part of me being in entrepreneurship after hating every moment of being part of it. So she, when she got out, she suddenly she overwhelmed herself of understanding that, you know, there are reasons for my living. Okay. At the same time, my dear friend, in at home, we have grandchildren. She's as concerned and comfortable with the grandchildren as well. So there are multiple purposes that I see in her. At one end, she enjoys her mural. At another end, she enjoys her time with the granddaughter. Oh, they are such a undividable force. Okay. Now look at it. Multiple ikigais. I just want to give you an examples of multiple ikigais. One may be supplementing and complementing the other. It may not be. It could be two different silos. No problem. But understanding yourself and finding out ikigai, okay, is the most important thing that we talk about. Okay. One second. Let me. What happened? Well, I did some. Yes, Vivek, you're still there. My goodness, I thought you must have gone.
Yes, we are here.
Only enjoying your Ricky guys.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I want to
really enjoy.
Thank you, Rajbhavan. But I just actually want a. This is full screen. I want to take. I'm looking at the full screen. Okay, fine. What I want to ask is that, you know, I have been going gaga, but are you with me? I just want to come to you and ask you, and are you with me? Is it okay? Can somebody give me some feedback, please? Oh, Bibu, yes, good. Dinesh Nair, how is it going? Hello, Viji, George Burgess, good.
Yes, sir. It's going very good, sir.
Thank you, Dinesh ji. Viji, are you enjoying?
Yeah, it's going on very well. Very good.
Soumya, please, is it going good? Soumya George. Okay, some of you have answered, so I would. I stop sharing and I go back. Okay, very good. Arun Pillai, is it going good?
Yes, sir, very much, sir. Enjoying the session. Thank you very much.
George, my friend, George Sakaria, is it going right?
Yeah, perfect. Doing good.
Yeah. Rajeshwari Mani, how is it, miss?
And definitely very interesting, sir. Thank you.
So your encouragement is my motivation. So I can go further, right?
Yes, most certainly.
Thank you very much. Madhav, why are you still there? Can't you go home? What are you doing there, Madhav?
I'm very much here. I'm doing something else also, but I'm listening to you. Your voice is like booming, so obviously I don't have to show my face. I can listen to you. Very good. Keep going.
Thank you, sir. Okay, let me go back to Ikigai. All right, so what are the grand essentials to happiness in life? Now, okay, again, I take a little bail or advanced jamming, munkur jamming. Why? Because, see, some of my audience here are very young people, okay? And those are people who would like to do something, who like to earn something, who like to recognize something, because they are at some lower levels of their hierarchy needs. So sometimes when I say happiness, peace, etc., probably they may think that, you know, it is not only for peace and happiness that we live. There are many other things that we live for. So therefore, I am taking an advanced bail because I am actually going by the principles of Ikigai and therefore trying to do justice to that. And using that, I am saying what is the happiness. So happiness, whether you are busy, whether you are not, whether you are active, whether you are not, whether you are indulging, whether you are not. There is an element of happiness that you can reserve for yourself. You find life to be much more simpler, meaningful, significant, and maybe what you call the meaning of purposeful. Okay, that's what I want to use the word for. Now, what are the grand essentials of happiness? Something to do. Lots of us, okay, particularly I had seen, you know, in the past, Kerala government used to retire people at the age of 55. And even now they do. It is 56. In Kerala, the life expectancy of a man is 74. And the life expectancy of a woman is about 78. So if you want to average it out, it's about 75, 76. So please understand, a person who gets employed somewhere about this 25, 38, 26, because these days employment date is more because they do their post-graduation engineering, this, that, etc. So at the age of 26, 27, etc., they get into a job. At the age of 55, they retire. So it's actually what? 30 years. Maximum that they work for the government. So if it is central government, maybe additionally 3 years or 4 years extra. Okay. But can you imagine a person who had been employed by the government gets retired and he had some good gala life at that time, maybe it's a secretariat or office or whatever, and then gets out of it, then he completely go astray, he completely go berserk because he doesn't know what to do. And happiness is gone, his schedules are gone, rituals are gone, his tea times are gone, all those things. So they find it extremely difficult to recap their life or recapture their life. Okay, and one of the reasons I had seen many retired personnel die soon thereafter because they've lost that purpose in life. They have simply forgotten and lost their purpose in life, so they give up on life. Okay, that is the case. Okay, so but if you have a purpose in life, like the people in Okinawa, okay, you will live naturally and you will live very well as the normal people do, okay, without being bedridden. Okay, and for that, what is that you require? You need happiness. And happiness come by what? Something to do. You must have something to do. Very important. You have been doing your job. You got retired. Nothing to do. Problem. Something to love. It could be people. It could be object. It could be book. It could be knowledge. It could be computer. It could be WhatsApp. It could be that or it could be that. Something to love. And something to hope for. So my dear friends, if these three things you find answers to at all point of your existence, you will not find life boring. You will not want to give up on life because you have something to do, you have something to love, and you have something to hope for. And we always say that hopes is what makes men live or human beings live. And along with the hope, you have something to love and somebody to love you, and you have something to do. And these are the grand essentials of life. Whether you are young, whether you are old, whether you are retired, whether you are whatever stages of life, if these three things are available to you, and you will be very happy. And that is what the book also says. So now the book, coming to Madhav had referred to the author. Okay, now I want to actually put the exact excerpts of this book. And what do they mean? What is it that they actually tried to go in the book? The first they say it says Ikigai is different for all of us. I have already said that. Okay, but one thing we have in common is that we are all searching for meaning. See, I know for sure that lots of us, while we externally show a semblance of being or a semblance of happiness or a semblance of satisfaction, may still be searching inside our mind. Still be searching inside our mind, finding out actually whether we, finding out many things for which we still don't find answers for. Okay. So he says Ikigai is different for all of us. And what we have in common is searching for meaning. When we spend our days feeling connected to what is meaningful to us, we live more fully. And when we lose that connection, we feel despair. That is exactly what I said in the last line. When we get disconnected for something to do, something to love and something to hope for, life is gone. You don't want to live. You're mechanically living. And what the book says is, it is for searching for the meanings of what you do. And it could be different for different people. So that is something that you have to bear in mind. And that go to the next one. The happiest people are not the ones who achieve the most. Okay. They are the ones who spend more time. They're the ones who spend more time than others in the stage of flow. Very simple English, as far as Ikigai book is concerned. Okay. It is not the lottery that you won. It is not the presidentship that you have actually attained. It is not the prime ministership that you have attained. Or it is not the tag. Today I had seen, you know, the running that happens, you know, because every year we have this richest man in the world, a post held by Bill Gates for more number of years. Later he gave to a guy called Garcia, who was Mexican. Then it went to, before which it was, later to that, there are other people. Now I believe Elon Musk is considered to be the richest man. Now everybody is trying, rushing to become the rich man, the richest man, the richest man, etc. Or the numero uno person. But the question that we need to ask them is, are you happy reaching this coveted position? Are you happy reaching this achievement of your life? Or are you at this point of time, okay, are you enjoying or are you in the flow? If you are not in the flow, you are not really enjoying. That means there is something wrong. Go to the next one. And here it says, okay, the exercise. One thing that everyone with clearly defined Ikigai has in common is that they pursue their passion no matter what. This is something that to be understood in perspective, my dear friends. Okay, you may be actually working something where you are not able to find the purpose. Okay, but you must pursue the passion that you have. Lucky people are those who find the passion in the job that they do, in the programming that they do, in the coding that they do, in the intellectual BPO process that they do, in the knowledge process that they do, in the manufacturing process that they do, in the work that they do. Okay. But the fact of life, you will realize, most of the people in front of me will realize, most of the people that I had come across had realized that actually in the job that they do, they are not having a passion. They're doing because it is what gives me the salary. But it doesn't give me any enjoyment. It doesn't give me my flow. It doesn't, therefore, it's not a passionate thing that I do. So if that is the case, search for that, you know, while being in the job or while getting out of the job. I will not unnecessarily recommend you to get out of your job and go for. Being in the job itself, you can find the passion. I've seen so many people. In fact, many people that I have counseled, I have told them, okay, fine. This job is an essential thing for you because dharma, you know, they say, you know, the kitchen stove has to work. For that, you need to have mula, money, and that is that you're earning. But there are so many other things that you can do. You can read, you can write, you can draw, you can speak, you can walk, you can do something to others, you can do charity work. There are so many things that you can do. And please understand, all of us, you know, we still say that, you know, you're in a job and you don't have time for everything, which is actually a misnomer. If you divide your day into three segments of 8 hours each, you only need 8 hours of sleep. You agree with me? Okay. You only do 8 hours of work. You also agree with me. There is still this another 8 hours that most of us waste. We waste lying in the couch, watching the TV, or doing gossiping, or doing nothing, or making mind very toxic by thinking of others, by being jealous of others, or scheming to bring down people, etc. that you do. That is the 8 hours that is spent. That 8 hours, okay, you can actually go with your passion for thing that you long for, the thing that you want for. So there is, please understand, you don't want to disturb your job. 8 hours you don't want to disturb. 8 hours of sleeping, I will never say you should not. You should definitely sleep 8 hours a day. So this 8 plus 8 hours, let's say it is reserved. The 8 hours that you work for gets you the mula, the employment, the compensation, the remuneration, the salary. The 8 hours of sleep, it is very required for you, for your body, mind, and soul. Now there is another 8 hours, my dear friend. And in that, take care, okay, another 4 hours you spend for things like, you know, whatever you want to do. Still there is 4 hours left. So in this 4 hours, you can still pursue your passion. You can still dance. You can still play. You can still go to the gym. You can still write, read, draw, paint. You can do whatever. You can do charity. You can help others. You can do so many things. So anybody who tells me that, okay, I don't have time because I am in my job, and my job, I don't have the passion, but so I'm thinking of retiring and going after my passion. That is not the right thing. Even while you are on a job which you don't enjoy that much, but still there is a possibility that you can find your ikigai. Okay, going to the next one. Our ability to turn routine tasks into moments of microflow, into something we enjoy, is key to our being happy, since we all have since we have to do such tasks. Again, this is a corollary to what I have said in the first paragraph. What it says is that, okay, the job, now I'm coming to the job. Here, you know, you have to really understand. I'm trying to put it in perspective. Now, I want to tell you a small joke in between. Okay, you know, what is it? When I was the area manager for HCL, Hindustan Computers Limited, at Kochi, way back in the mid-80s, okay, I had this accounts officer called Kishore. These are real names. So Kishore's wife was pregnant, and she was taken to the hospital for delivery. So to give him, you know, dairyam, to give him courage, I also went along with it. And Kishore always wanted to have a baby girl. Okay, so at Vijaya Hospital, Kacheripadi, okay, when the delivery was over, Dr. Sumukhan came. Okay, Mr. Kishore, he asked. So I was standing outside the labor room with Kishore. Kishore was expecting the baby girl to happen. And Dr. Sumukhan came and said, Kishore, congratulations. Mr. Kishore said, yes, congratulations. You have become a father, a baby boy. I looked at Kishore's face. And it was like Adur Gopalakrishnan movie for 15 seconds. You know, suddenly disappointment, face going black, visible in the eye. Okay. And that 5 seconds later, realization come into his mind. No, the baby has come. The baby is healthy. It is not boy or girl that matters. Then once the realization comes, then the next 55 seconds he was trying to bring in the happiness. Then very sheepishly, Kishore told me, doesn't matter. A baby boy was my second choice. That's what he said. It doesn't matter. Okay, I wanted a baby girl, but baby boy was my second choice. God was kind. He gave me the second choice. So first choice is okay. Didn't get it. I had a second choice. The second choice happened. So this is what I think you must look at your job also, actually. This is what you should look at your employment. In your employment, okay, I don't enjoy my employment. Now I'm asking you the question, is there anything in your employment that you can enjoy? So in that, if you can cut that your employment part into multiple pieces, and that is what they say, the micro flow of moments in your job. Okay, some part of your job is good, some part of your job is bad. So if you cut your job element into multiple flows, and you say that, okay, this I like, this I like, this I don't like, this I like, this I like. Okay, no problem. Okay, still you will realize that there are so many elements in your job that you can actually enjoy. So that is the beauty of it. So please don't say that you don't enjoy your job. So this is an attitudinal issue. You're not applying your faculty. You're not applying your empathy senses. You're not applying your emotions correctly. In your job itself, there are so many microflows that you can enjoy. And that is what Ikigai says. So don't say that I got a job which I didn't like. I'm doing the job because there's a lot of salary in it. And I want salary because I want my kitchen to run. I want my family to be looked after. But I am not enjoying it. So I will work till about 55 years. Then I will retire. Then I will paint. Then I will play. Then I will go to temple. Then I will look after. I will do charity. Then I will do this thing. Actually speaking, you will never end up doing this thing because you wasted the 30 years. In which, during the job itself, there are so many microflows that you could have enjoyed. In addition to that, as I told in the first paragraph, if you cut your day into three time elements, the third time element of 8 hours, what are you doing with that? You can actually pursue your passion even during then. So please, please keep this in your mind. And the last excerpt of Ikigai book is, it says, you know, they were actually saying that it is artists and people who actually carry the torch of their, you know, they are artists enjoy, you know, that say that people of art, they enjoy Ikigai moments. Okay, Ikigai moments, much better. Okay. It is art in all its forms is an Ikigai that can bring happiness and purpose to our days. Enjoying or creating beauty is free and something all human beings have access to. Okay, now here they have been actually saying that, you know, people who are working hard in engineering, in production, in manufacturing, etc., probably may be so busy that they may not be enjoying, but at least people in art can enjoy, and that is what another highlights of their book that they've actually brought it down. But I had taken time to explain to you all these things very clearly to you. And I also had taken time to explain to you this multiple intelligence and the higher form of intelligence called intrapersonal, in which discovering yourself and what keeps you going. If you understand that, take that and apply that to your job, or convert your job into multiple microflows, and those microflows that you enjoy. And the 8 hours that you don't spend for job and sleeping, you still have time to pursue your happiness and enjoy. So this is the basic thoughts of the book, the basic highlights of the book that is coming from that. Next is, sorry, you see this chart. Okay, this is a lovely one. Now there are four circles, or there are four elliptical circles that I will say. Okay, now I would rather say it's a four circles. Let me take the extreme left one, which is, what are you good at? What are you good at? I'm good at reading. I'm good at writing. I'm good at running. I'm good at analyzing. I'm good at selling. I'm good at acting. Whatever I'm good. What are you good at? The next question is, what the world needs. If you're part of a society, if you want to contribute to the society from which you want to gain a sense of satisfaction, from that perspective, look at what the world needs. And go back to what you love. What you love doing, what you're good at may be something, what you love doing may be something else. And the fourth circle where it says what you can be paid for. That is, there are many cases where your vocation, where your enjoyment, or whether whatever that you do, you're also paid for. So now, between what you're good at and what you love is your passion. I repeat, between what you are good at and what you love doing is your passion. If both are positive, your passion is at the highest. Between what you love and what the world needs lies your mission. There's a purpose, a mission. Okay. So one is your passion. That is the passion that lies between what you're good at and what you love doing. Many often what you're good at is what you love doing. And between what you love and what the world needs is your mission. It's a part of your contribution. It is a part of the sense of satisfaction that you can derive. And between what the world needs and what you are paid for is your vocation, it's your job. And between what you are paid for, what you can be paid for, what you're good at, is your profession. Okay. And sometimes there could be this confusion between your vocation and your profession. Now, I would like to, just for the clarity, let's say you have passed an MBA, but you're doing a job of an analyst. So you'll say, Your vocation, I'm an analyst. By profession, I'm in management. So you understand. So that is the difference between vocation and profession. So this is the circles that intercepting. And right at the intercept of all these circles, what is Ikigai, which I will explain to you in big graphics later. But let me take you to this, the explanations of this for a while. Okay. That is the question that is asked. What you're good at, what you love, what the world needs, and what we can be paid for. I'm trying to give you the explanations of this. I will start with what the world needs, the mission. Okay. Now here, these are the questions that one is asked. What are the top three core values that you have? Integrity, empathy, or helpfulness, whatever be that case, ethical, it could be anything. Next element is, what are there any social or environmental or economic problem that you want to solve today? You know it, you know. Do you know, in people in front of me, there is an agreement between Mali, Maldives and Australia. How many of you in this team knows that there is an agreement between Maldives and Australia? And what is that agreement? There is an agreement between Maldives and Australia is that if Maldives actually get inundated, or if it is, if Maldives is going to be submerged by water, which is a reality because the seawater is rising because of global warming, because of carbon emission. Okay. Now, in the event of that, Australia has accepted to take the Maldivians into Australia. That is the agreement. Okay. Now, why I said this is, there are so many similar environmental factors around you that you can actually help solve. But there are many other economic elements that you can help solve. There are social elements that you can help solve. So are you looking at that? That is as a mission. The third thing I want to ask, if you were to ask the people around you, what would they say, what you advocate for? What is that you stand for? I'm saying you ask people around you, they will say what you are advocate for, because sometimes, you know, you may not be fully clear as to many things among many things you do, that what you advocate for. If it is not clear to you, you ask the people around you, they will tell you what this person advocate for. And the next question is, are there causes in your community or in the world that touch you emotionally? COVID, for instance, you know, what can you do something for the COVID? In fact, I was very enamored when Madhav Chandran, etc., had been running around. See, when the flood happened, actually, when the flood happened, in the particularly the first flood, which is quite harsh on the state of Kerala, quite unexpected, and Kerala never expected that this would happen. But the nature was such that it gave it in abundance, and the state was in completely undergoing the fury of the nation. And Madhav and his team and Rotarians all around, they ran around. They got a lot of materials organized and started distributing that free to several hundreds of camps. Rajmohan, Madhav, Vivek, so many of them that I had seen around, they have been doing that. Okay, these are the causes in your community or in the world that touch you most. Okay. Or are there any volunteer organization that seem to fit or align well with your values? You must search for. You must, because you are part of the society. If you really wanted to see that you want to join something where you can contribute and something that can be taken as your mission, you can go and find out, is there any organization that I can be part of where I can use my core values? So this is the question that you need to ask, what the world need. Okay, if you ask this question, but let me tell you, my dear friends, several of us don't ask this question. We are too timid to ask this question. We are too timid to understand what is our core values. We are too timid to actually partake in helping the people, because we feel that, you know, that is another problem. And, you know, there are several instances that when I had asked people as to why didn't you go out to help, they will tell, you know, if I go out to help, people may something and say something, then I may not be able to stand by that. So I don't want to take any panga. Okay, I may say this, I may say that. So I don't want to take any problem. So I'm not doing. So if that is what is in your mind, then you can never actually fulfill your mission. Okay, I'm referring to mission, not passion. No, there is a connect between mission and passion that we will come to. Okay, let me go to the next set of questions. That is, and that set of question is on your vocation, on your job. One second, water. Here, what does it say at your job? What are your strengths? What do you find easy to do? Several of you can actually ask this question. No, in fact, I have so many good friends also. I have George Sakria, I have George Verghese. Lots of us had asked this question many number of times. What do you feel are your strengths? And I have been able to identify, they have been able to identify, because we have been able to talk to each other and see. So what do you find it easy to do? Okay. Second question is, but what activities do you experience the flow? That is, when does your time fly? That is, certain jobs, certain activity that I do, I don't know how time flies. In fact, you know, my president Madhav will realize that, you know, he had given me again, anecdotally giving an example. Madhav had given me the entrusted with me responsible to running the programs, the evening lecture programs, okay, keynote programs. And he said, okay, you can manage them. So when this person comes to speak, he may speak for about 20 minutes, 25 minutes. It is a 1 hour session. Close to 30, 35 minutes I engage him. Okay. And really, my dear friends, I really do not understand how the time flies in there. I don't even know. I just feel that it's only 5 minutes that I have started asking the questions and engaging him, and suddenly it has become 7:50. That is because I have been thoroughly enjoying what the flow, I have been enjoying the flow. So in your vocation, do you do anything where you experience time flying like nobody's business? The third question is, what is it something you could do, spend hours actively, that is without feeling tired? This is an activity in which you will feel fully engaged and won't be thinking about doing anything else. Certain things you would want to do and continue to do and continue to do and continue to do it. I had given this example of my wife, you know. She was sitting in a place, okay, using the brush, sitting in a place with all sort of using, going and doing it 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, 4 hour, 5 hour, and enjoying doing that. And somebody who watches from outside, my goodness, putting the dots on the painting, my goodness, it's such a terrible thing. That's what I felt, but she doesn't feel that. She feels like doing it for hours together, enjoying it. That is something that you have to see. And the last one is, what did you like doing when you were a child? This question is purposely asked because when children they don't have the level of responsibilities, okay, certain things they enjoy doing it. It could be games, it could be sports, it could be dance, it could be play, it could be oration, it could be anything, or it could be even studies. It could even be studies. So that question, when you ask at your childhood, okay, what is it that you enjoyed doing it? That also could give you an answer. So you understand what you're good at from these questions. Now, why these questions are asked is, you know, these questions must stimulate you to give you the answer. When you complete this, like the mission, you must understand where you should join, what you should do based on the core values that you have. And the second one is about your job. Okay, what part of the job and what job that you should do where you can go on doing it happily without it. And if you have not been able to identify it, saying in your childhood, what were you actually doing? Some element of that can be brought into the job. Now, let me go to the next one, which is called passion. Okay, what do you love doing it? Okay, what would you do if money wasn't an option? This is a question that it is asking. If you are not to be worried about the money, what would you have done? Okay, you're saying that, okay, there is a kitchen that I have to look after, therefore I am doing this. And you can, one second, okay, right. Yes. Yes. Okay, what do you love? So what do you do if money was an option? If you had some spare time, what would you do to spend your time, that time doing? If you were asked to present to a room full of people on a topic, what would it be? Okay, which is subject that you feel so much passionate about that you can speak. I still remember. I mean, it is again Vivek is here, so Vivek, this is something related to Vivek's dad. We have a club where we were running a school for children suffering from physically and mentally challenging children. Okay, so it was in the initial stages of it. The school was called Pratyasha. I'm referring to something close to about 20 years back. And since it was a newly formed club, we had called the the most well-known past district governor of that association. So we brought him to have a look at that. Okay, he came late because something held him up and he came a little late. By then we had completed those activities at school, because these children, they can't wait. These children, you know, they were mentally, physically challenged children. Okay. Now, he came in with a sense of seeing all, which he could only see some of them. But he was so excited about it. He was seeing it and explaining. Now, he stood there right at the door, I'm referring to Mr. Venugopal Sigovin, okay, standing at the door, passionately gave us his thoughts for close to about 40 minutes. Okay, now it was something that he really had held it in his heart. It was also something as an activity that we clearly wanted to do, and therefore it gelled so very well. And the passion of him on that subject was so evident as much as the passion of us in conducting that thing. Okay. So that passion, that's what. So if you are given a topic to speak about, okay, if Rajmohan Nair is asked to do a topic, or if Vivek is asked to speak about a topic, or if Madhavi is asked to speak about a topic, what is it that you speak about, and what will be, what will you get you excited about? So that is what is a passion. Something you go after. And the fourth thing that they ask is about the profession. So we have actually looked at the mission, we have looked at the passion, we have looked at the vocation, and the question that you will ask, that you want to find answers, is your profession. Okay, the questions here are, do you feel that you're doing enough in your career path? Ah, good question. So you're saying, many people who are actually employed will ask this, so I don't know what is my career path, so I can't answer this. That's what, do you feel that you're doing enough in your career path? I remember a person called David Copeland. He started as a as an attender, that we call an attender, or a fourth what you call an assistant employee, and doing the, we call it a pure job in a company. So this guy was so good at, he'll complete his job and he'll go and ask his colleagues and friends and seniors, sir, I can do this for you, I can do this for you, what I can do for you, sir, etc. And that he went on asking. While he retired as chief executive officer of the same company. Okay. Now just look at him. Copeland, David Copeland, that is his name. The books are there. You can actually refer to, or you can Google him out. So he while coming into the job as an attender, a job as an assistant, a job as a peon that you call, or janitor, or whatever. So that person had that much of feeling, or that much of energy in him, to go and help people, go and understand things, go and study things, to move up in his career path. So many of us here don't even know what will be our next job, what will be our next promotion, what will be that I'll be doing after this. And don't you think that it is time that you should look at and frame a career path for yourself? You must have joined as a programmer. You must have joined as a sales manager. You must have joined as an insurance executive. You must have joined as a, you must have joined as anything, whatever you call it. Or you must have joined in whichever capacity. Can't you actually identify a career path for yourself? The second question is there any overlap with your career and your other aspect of ikigai? That is, my career is this, but my ikigai is this. So therefore, there's a clash. That's a question that you like to ask. And if there are answers, you can change either your career, or you can actually consciously try to change your ikigai. Okay. The third one, do you use your talents and passion in what you do as a career? Do you use your talent and passion in what you do in for a career? In the career that you do, in the profession that you have, are you applying your talent? Are you applying your passion? Or are you saying that, hey, this is, I'm a professional. These days, you know, actually the word professional is very, very highly, what do you call, mis-explained by a lot of people. In fact, a lot of people, when we actually ask them, you know, I am a professional, they'll say like this. I am a professional. Therefore, since I am a professional, I don't get into these emotional things. Actually, it's a stupid thing to say. You may be a professional, and part of that, there are emotions, okay? And your talent and your passion, which you are emotionally holding, if you can put it in your career, you can do it well. But if you're saying that I'm a professional, nothing affects me, it's a stupid thing to say. But I had seen, in fact, whenever we talk to people, oh, I'm not a professional. He's a professional. And therefore, it doesn't affect him. That's the wrong thing, I feel. Okay. You're a professional is okay. But your passion, if you're able to put in your profession and finding more meaning in that, is something that you need to ask. And the last question here is, did you study, or can you study further to develop your career? Okay, what professional developments do you have planned? How many of you sitting in here know that I would like to learn this and this and this? How many of you sitting in here want to know what skills that you must acquire, soft skills or hard skills? How many of you sitting in here think that what are the subjects that you study which can give you a better job, which could be connected to your passion and mission, so that you can enjoy all elements together? So these are the questions that you must be asking. Okay, so all the four elements that I explained to you, therefore, I am coming back to that circles. Look at the ikigai circle again, my dear friends. The same circles, colors are different. What you're good at, what you really love, what the world needs, and what you can get paid for. If all those things that you can, in Malayalam there is a word, samanvayam. ഈ നാല് കാര്യങ്ങളിലും സമന്വയം. Or if you are able to synergize all these things, right at the middle lies your ikigai. Okay, and it is explained further by saying, okay, earlier it said your passion, your mission, vocation, etc. And here they are saying between the quadrant, between the circle, between what you can be paid for and what you are good at, satisfied but feeling useless. What you are, what you really love doing and what the world needs, delighted and fulfilled but broke. Okay, and between what the world need and what you can be paid for, entertained and purposeful but still unfulfilled. So these questions actually can come up in your mind. Okay, and that is the area which is not the ikigai area in the middle that you see. The middle area here, as I put my cursor around, this is the ikigai area. This is where you should be able to find your synergy of the thoughts and synergy of action. Outside is where you can have disenchantment, and these are the questions of disenchantment that you can actually face in ikigai. Okay, the next slide. Okay, this is the process of ikigai, wherein it says what is the first one, what is the second one, what is the third one, and what should be the fourth one. Okay, you can start what the world needs. If you really want to find ikigai, my dear friends, Radhmohan Nair, I can see you yawning to glory. Go to sleep. Okay, now coming back to this one, where do you want to start? You would like to start at the what is, see, rather than saying what I'm good at, what I'm passionate about, what I can be paid for, start like what does the world need? Just look at that. What does the world need? What is that the world need? Then you go into what you're good at. So the question that you're asking is, what does the world need? Then you go to what are you good at? And then you ask, what would you love to do, love doing? And you say, what you can be paid for. So if this growth path that you take, okay, you can find the synergy between all these things, and right at the middle, you can identify your ikigai, your reason for being, your raison d'etre, okay, your purpose of living can be there. So the process that the book says in the end is that, okay, how you can do it, you find what the world needs, find what you're good at, find what you love doing, and do that for your this thing. Okay, now I give you this example of Sachin Tendulkar. You must see, at the age of 16, while he was the plus one, he has taken a bat and went to Lahore. That's what I'm jokingly saying. He went as a part of the Indian cricket team and went to Lahore at the age of 16. And thereafter, he never looked back in his career. What he enjoyed doing, it was his career, isn't it? He always wanted to play cricket. He went on playing cricket till the age of 40. Till the age of 40. Yes, of course, there was talent, plenty of talent. And in his case, he was ambidextrous. You know, there are some people, both hands are equally powerful. Sachin Tendulkar and Sourav Ganguly are two people who are having ambidextrous. If you know, Sachin writes by his left leg, left hand. He bats right-handed. Do you know that? Sourav Ganguly bats left-handed, but bowls right-handed. So these are all people who are ambidextrous. Both hands are equally powerful. Okay. So because both hands are equally powerful, he in the game, he did much better. Plus he had the talent. Plus he had the eye for that. So at the age of 16, he went on playing when he was in the plus one. When he was doing his plus one, went to play cricket. He went on playing cricket till he was 40. All of us paid money to watch him play cricket, isn't it? All of us Indians, to the extent we were so happy, so contented with him, we said, give him a Bharat Ratna. It is a very rare instance in our country where a sportsman at the mid 30s, he became a Bharat Ratna receiver. Now just look at it. Okay. Now that is one part of the your talent and what you like, Samanvayam. Okay. Here, and also there is an equation of what is he paid for. He's one of the richest sportsmen in the country, you will realize. So what are the three things that has found meaning in there? What found meaning? What I am good at, what I love doing, and what I am paid for. It got synergized. And then today, he stands for many causes in the world. Of course, he also do a lot of advertising. You set that aside. There's so many things that you do for charity. There's so many things that you do where the world needs. So that is where he has been able to, just to give you an example. And this can be done by all of you, my dear friends. So at any point of your life and career, you can do. That is, you start by finding out that in your own sphere, in the area that you are, in the place that you are, in the company that you are, in the community that you are, you just ask this question: what is the world around me needs? And then say, what are you good at? What you enjoy doing, and what can be paid for? That can become your vocation. So your vocation become something that you like, something that you're good at, and something that gives value to the society. And that is where the Ikigai come in. Okay. And at the crossroads, at the center point, is where Ikigai comes in. I hope I have been able to get to the process part of it. Okay. And then going into the last slide, the almost last slide, which says, excellence is not an act, but a habit. I don't want to go. This is the last slide. This says 10 rules of Ikigai. Okay. The 10 rules of Ikigai. Okay. It says, stay active, don't retire. Rajmohan Nair, don't retire. Okay. Rajmohan Nair already had taken his career path for the next 5 years, of course. And so, Binu Kunduran,
don't retire. Sir, it is for 10 years.
Yeah. Madhav Chandran, don't retire. Bahura Saab, don't retire. All my young friends there, never retire in your life. Always stay active. See, I have given this example. I had seen so many people who come out of their job, in the next 3 to 4 years, they die. And until then, they were in the job, they had never problem. They had no heart problem. They had never sugar problem, nothing. Suddenly they came out, they became alone, didn't know what to do. There was nothing to do. There was nobody to love. There was nothing to love. And there wasn't anything that he could do, and they pass away. Okay, so stay active and don't retire. Okay, the second element is don't fill your stomach. That means, sorry. Second is take it slow. Don't. I will give me a second. There is an emergency call. I am sorry for taking a break on this. Sunil. Hello, Sunil. Yeah, please, Sunil. Yeah, Kega. Sorry, my dear friends, I'm sorry. This is an interruption that I shouldn't have allowed. Okay, the second is, one second. Hello. Sunny.
Hi, Babu. Anakoy lalo.
Hello. Nyan mute aayirunnu.
Ma chairman full time irikkiyaanu. Chairman aanu inathu usharaayathu.
Very sorry, dear friends. I had actually asked for a friend of mine to get me some medicines. So he was calling me from somewhere. Very sorry. I apologize for the interruption. Okay. So the first one is to stay active, never retire. Lots of you in front of me are very young people. So the thought of retirement wouldn't have come to your mind at least at all. But there are some of you whom I have talked to, you know, saying stay active. Take it slow. So don't jump at things, you know. Don't go at a breakneck speed that you want to reach your death very fast. There are some people, if you want to write an epitaph on their cupboard or wherever they're buried.
Tombstone.
Yeah, tombstone. That's right. Thank you very much, Secretary Sir. I was
just joined in, sir. Sorry for the delay. No interruption, please continue. I'm listening.
Okay, right. So you want to don't let somebody write an epitaph for you on the tombstone where it says, "Here lies a human being who wanted to die yesterday." Don't write an epitaph on your tomb like that. Okay, don't get the epitaph. It should be that, okay, here lies a contented soul. That should be the epitaph that should be coming in. So don't take everything in a breakneck hurry and reach there so fast. I had seen, in fact, you know, I have a doctor friend who had all the qualifications of the world, all the achievements of the world, but he was only 45. It's a real case, no names. He had all the qualifications of the world, and all the achievements as a doctor. He's a surgeon, okay. But at the age of 45, he was saying, what do? I have seen it and all. I have been there and done it all. Because he has taken his life in the supersonic speed. Actually, he went with his life in a supersonic speed. So at the age of 45, if such a brilliant doctor, such a well-known doctor with such high qualification, and at such high level of recognition by patients, feels empty in the heart. You understand? Feels empty in his mind. It's a problem. So take it slow. Enjoy every moment of your life. Enjoy your eating. Enjoy your growing. Enjoy your activities. So take time. Slowly come it in. Let it slowly come in. And the third one, don't fill your stomach. It says, don't fill it full. Keep something vacant, you know, so that there is always a need. There is always an urge. There is always an aspiration that can actually come about. If you are actually at the first place, if you have a full stomach, you may have gastric problems. You understand, right? A person with a full stomach is somebody whom you don't want to be nearby. You know the reasons. Okay, so first of all, don't be anybody whose stomach is full. Now, by completely filling up your stomach, you are not leaving anything for any other aspiration. So what it says is, leave space for your aspirations to develop. Leave space for your want to develop. Leave space for your ikigai to develop. Okay, that is what it says. Fourth one, surround yourself with good friends. We call it satsang, actually. In some language, we call it satsang. Sat means, okay. Sat means, you know what. Sang means, you know what. Sat, satyam, sang, togetherness. Okay. Being together in place. So, if you are going to be with naysayers, I was actually reading an article about how come all these drug peddlers and all these smugglers, etc., behave so brutally in their life. I was actually reading the story of Escobar. If anybody who knows about the biggest drug lord of the world, Escobar, you will understand. If you read the story of him, or if you see the movie of him, you will realize that. They're so brutal. If there's somebody they like, they kill. They kill, they stab. They bomb a place. I was thinking as to what sort of a thought that can come into your mind, okay? Because they are surrounded by such toxinated people. They're surrounded by such vicious people. They're doing such vicious activity. They're seeing such vicious act that is happening around them. How can you expect these people to be having humanity in their heart? How can you expect these people to be aspiring? So what actually makes them think is that killing, that brutality. Now, do you want to be? So surround yourself with me, good friends. Surround with love. Surround with affection. Surround with growth. Surround with all those things. Okay. Not with those people who are very toxic. And please, all of you know, I don't have to tell this. We are actually surrounded by so many toxic people and so many toxic elements around us. So it is unto us when you try to discover yourself, when you try to aspire yourself, when you try to be passionate about something that you want to do, the first thing that you need to do is to be out of this action. The one advice that I give to most of the MBA graduates, wherever they call me to take a class or to give them a motivation, is that I tell them this. I tell them, whether it is your dad or mom, your teacher or a professor or a dean or whosoever, but if he's negatively oriented, don't be with him. That's what I tell them. Because you be with negatively oriented people, okay, the flow is going to be negative, and no enjoyment, no aspiration, no passion can thrive in that vicinity. Okay. The fifth one is get in shape for the next birthday. Aha. You know, you remember in the 10 questions, one question that I asked, I did not spend much of time, is that how much of exercises that you do? And lots of us keep bloating up, and lots of us keep eating junk foods, and lots of us do not exercise, and lots of us have lots of problems in our body and mind. That is because, okay, you see, it is like this. How many of you, in the right frame of your mind, goes near your bed, in the next 5 minutes you're asleep? I hear every day so many people who tells me that nalla uranga nahi patila kal main neend nahi paya. Okay, why? I ask them why? Because I don't know, some thought, some this, some that. You know what? Your body is not fit enough to sleep. You are not giving that exercises to your body. You are not getting the excess out of your body. You are not allowing your monitoring part of the body to work when you are asleep. Okay, there are so many things in your body. It is those nerves and waves which actually cleans you out when you sleep. You are not giving that opportunity. If you don't sleep, next day you wake up as a zombie. You wake up as a zombie. So how many of you actually want to wake up as a zombie? So please see that you give your atma, your soul, your three elements. You know the three sheets. What are the three sheets that I have mentioned? Okay, your prana, your mind, and your intellect. Okay, these three things, sufficient food for thought, so that you know you are around. So please, that is why get in the shape for your next birthday. Next birthday is incidental. Get in shape for every day is my suggestion. Keep smiling. It is very, and you know what? More than corona, the most contagious thing in the world is smile. Corona happens only when somebody actually stand 2 meters in between you and do a sneezing or do a talking. Smile, you can do even 50 meters. If somebody sees you smiling, they also smile. Such a contagious thing. Smile makes a world a better place to live. So keep smiling. Keep smiling. Don't worry about I have this bhakti, you know. And actually, if I keep smiling, all my bhakti shows. But I don't mind. I still keep smiling. Okay. It doesn't matter if somebody says that SR Nair has bhakti. No problem. I don't mind, but I keep smiling. That is the element. So wherever, and because it is contagious, it makes the world a better place to live. Okay. Connect with nature. Here it is mentioned as reconnect. I say completely, always connected to the nature. You know, be happy when you see the full moon. Well, remembering, people say when somebody who sees a full moon is a mad guy. No. I'm not saying that. When the full moon keeps you happy, when you see the sea, the sea, the samundar, it keeps you happy. When you see the elephant, that keeps you happy. When you see the forest, that keeps you happy. When you see people, that keeps you happy. And that is what the connection that happened. Connect with the nature. Nature is the only reality around us. Baki, everything is very synthetic. People made, man made. Okay, nature is not man made. Nature is made by itself. Okay, so connect to the nature and be with the nature. Okay, and this is the sixth, eighth one. Always maintain an attitude of gratitude. An attitude of the gratitude that you maintain always gives you, always take you forward. A person who is grateful always remain humble too. I'm not saying synthetic gratitude. You know, these days, hi, bye, thank you. No, that is not what I mean. You must, when you feel the gratitude, when you feel the thankfulness, you must mean it. You must mean it. And that thanks touches so many hearts around you. While it touches so many hearts around you, it actually keeps you so humble. So it's a beautiful thing to happen, the attitude of gratitude. Okay, it's a beautiful thing that you must maintain. The ninth one, live in the moment. All of us are worried. You know, I have a lot of, I fight with so many people. In fact, my friends here, Vivek, Rajmohan, etc. say SR Nair is actually a fighter. Okay, he fights for so many unnecessary things also, they say, and that is my problem. Okay, but the fact here is that you live in the moment. Lots of fight that I do with people are who tells me, ingana chedal angane aagum. If I do like this, this will happen. I said, how do you know this will happen? No, because in that case it happened. I said, did it happen to you? No, it didn't happen to me. Then why do you want to say that? Why do you want to say that tomorrow it is gonna be like this? Why do you want to say that yesterday was a bad thing? See, you know what? No, the current is also called present, you know. Today, what we live in the moment is also called present. And what is another meaning of present? Gift. So what is present is the best gift that you can get. Please realize, what is present? What is tomorrow? You don't know. What is yesterday is that is went by. What is present is that you live by, and that's the moment, and that is meaning what? Present means what? Gift. It's the best gift that can come to you. So live in the moment. And the last is follow your reason death. Follow your ikigai. Follow your purpose and find meaning in life. These are all the 10 rules that the authors have finally put in the ikigai. It all started by watching the Okinawa people, okay, and saying that how come they live long, how come they live simple, and how come they live natural, and they went and searched and found out, and they said these are all the reasons that made the people of Okinawa live well, live long, live natural, live happy, and live peaceful. And that is what I would also urge all of you. I must definitely thank all of you for giving me this opportunity, but I have these questions for you. Are you thinking? So many people are sitting in front of me. Are you thinking? Are you happy? Or are you feeling confused?
Yeah.
And to ask the questions, are you feeling happy to ask the question? Are you thinking to ask the questions? Are you feeling confused to ask the questions? Do ask the questions. This is a question time. I have actually taken it up to about 4:46, 4:45 now. I have about 10 to 15 minutes of question. I would be happy to answer your questions. Therefore, I am getting back to my board. Thank you very much. Okay, this is a question time. I'm getting out of my, I'm stopping my sharing and I'm getting back to my, right. Yes, I'm available for questions. Thank you very much. How many of you are here? Oh, when we started, we were 49. It has become 35. Great. So that many people are, so many confused people have left. Okay. Any question, please?
Some of them have gone for meditation.
Bala, thank you very much. You are such a positive by the person.
Good evening, SR sir. Vinod here.
Yes,
so thanks for the wonderful re-energizing session. This is, day-to-day life, we need to pause and re-energizing. This was really helpful and 3 hours vanished like that. Thanks for that. So it was more of maybe a lighter question on that 40 marks question. So yeah. What is the ideal marks? Does it mean that 40 is the best one or, because something like, the social media was, how much you are active on social media was one question. So, from that perspective, when we look at somebody who is not so active on social media, maybe, that's why that confusion came up. So. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Vinod. Madhav, you know who is this Vinod? He is a speaker. Vinod actually had come home for a holiday. Okay. So I said, Vinod, you are free. And he said, yes. I said, join the party. That is why Vinod is here. And he is asking questions. Okay, Vinod, thank you very much. See, social media, fundamentally, when most of the people use the word social media, we mean these days it negatively. That is one thing that we need to understand. But when I spoke about that particular question, social media, I said, how socially active are you on the media? That's what I meant. Okay. So therefore, socially active aspect, if you take it, whether you are part of the social media or not, how much are you socially active is a question that was asked. So Vinod, take it from that perspective. I did not take it from the perspective of you being part of the Facebook or Insta or LinkedIn. I actually referred it from the, but why did I put it is because the youngsters understand the question better than us people. Okay, because their social interaction happens only on social media. That's why I put the word social media. But otherwise, what I meant is socially active and social listening. So there is nothing negative about it. So being socially active is the best thing to happen. Now, to answer your first question, 40 out of 40, nothing like that happens, But I would feel that if anybody who scores somewhere between about 30 to 40 should be a good score, because the aspirations, the dream, the hope, the love, okay, that is there. That is why they go to that side of the answering. Okay, people who give that seldom answer and get it between about 0 to 10 are people who have no dreams to dream of. Who have no aspirations to do, who feel that, okay, they're retired. And something like we see in products and service, in products, you call, what is it? Expiry date. In products that you see expiry date, people who think that they have crossed their expiry date. And those are all the people who will go to the extreme, right? So Vinod, I would rather, Vivek, Vinod Chandran, right?
Yes.
Sarji,
but between 30 and 40 could be a good score, Vinod. Yes, yeah, right. Yes, sir.
There is something in the chat. Sorry, I think Vivek should do that. There's something in the chat box which gels very well with what you said. If we can have a look at that and then comment on it.
No, what I was, I was saying that in the last 1 year and in the current year, social media is perhaps the only interaction that you would have other than with family.
Okay,
so social media. are you on social media is equal to, are you talking to anybody else?
I didn't get you. One second. So suddenly I went to the chat and I couldn't see this here. I would be happy if you can read it out to me, my dear friend.
No, what I was saying in the chat, sir, was that social media is perhaps the only interaction that anybody would have had in the last 1 year and in the current year, and we don't know for how many more months. Are you on social media is equivalent to, are you talking to other people?
Absolutely. That is what I meant. That is exactly what I was trying to tell Vinod also, because we live in a, there is this lovely book written by this author called Anand, and the title of the book is called Al Kootathil Thaniye.
All right.
Yes. Al Kootathil Thaniye. You are actually lonely in the crowd. This is exactly what we are in, aren't we? You know, we are actually among this huge population of 8 billion people and 140 lakhs Indians, 140 crores Indian, but we are alone. And we are so alone that we are even be forced to be alone from our wives and our children, right? So much of quarantining, so much of social distancing. So what can come in handy is only this, right?
Yes, with your permission, just to add on, I was reading on a T-shirt, it was written, the rules for years. 2019, they said avoid negative people. 2020, avoid positive people.
Yeah.
2021, avoid people. But I beg to differ a bit with Sariga in the sense that bars got closed only 1 week back. So there was a lot of interaction, at least there.
Back to you. You always have this lovely aspect of, you know, putting everything with the humor and the wit. I really appreciate you for that. And you also have very good level of observation. So both are actually giving you enough of combination, synergistic combination for you. Any other question, my dear friends? Hello.
Hi, sir. If I may, this is more of an observation. It's not really a question. I was thinking about the Ikigai framework, the diagram that you had showed us.
Yeah.
And if I may, I'm just going to take a moment to refer to my phone where I took a picture of it.
Yeah.
And there's one particular place where you talk about progressing from one side of the diagram to the other, 1, 2, 3, and a 4.
Right.
I just wanted to observe that, very often to be able to move from one section to the other requires a few things. It requires self-awareness. It requires an awareness of the world.
Yeah.
It requires a willingness to be honest. And it requires a willingness to acquire skills.
Yes.
And all of these are actually kind of hard to come by, because in the current world where a vulnerability is seen as a negative and asking questions is seen as, you know, okay, this person doesn't know something. It becomes very important to stay courageous enough to say that I'm happy with my job, but, you know, in order to increase my sense of fulfillment in terms of do I sleep better, I probably need to change something, because changing something involves, whether we like it or not, opinions. And we are all subject to opinions, especially as women, subject to lots of opinions from lots of people. So the courage to stand up to those opinions. So I just wanted to make an observation that to move between these requires a tremendous amount of talent and conviction, which unfortunately not everyone has, or some of us really have to struggle to gather. So.
Very well said. I must really appreciate
palms are sweaty.
A lovely one, and I couldn't agree more. So it's a. I'm so happy that I, by the end of a class like this, you know, there is a person who is actually coming in because of the absorption of the input that you have done so much, that you have come to ask this, not ask this, make this communication. I totally agree with you that, you know, to move from one to the other, so much of awareness, so much of willingness, so much of aspirations, and so much of learning. So much of skills that one has to acquire from move one to the other. And you know, you also know that the reason by which so many people die away or so many people go away right in the middle than reaching their actualization or not reaching the self-transcendence is only because of this, because they struggle a lot with the world, with the people, with the opinion, with the awareness or the lack of awareness and the willingness to do. Okay. But we also come across so many people who have the willingness to do. And there are exceptions, but there are still good number of exceptions who have had that willingness to do and reached the place. Okay. Whom
they have actually recognized themselves, that is individually, and many of us also stand up to recognize themselves. Okay, but those numbers are small. Rajesh, I totally agree with you. Those numbers are small. But the fact is, you and I can do something on this. You know, I'm just digressing a little to come to this. Okay, now I have a friend. I have a friend. We don't meet very often. We meet very seldom. But whenever we meet, we shake hands. And he gives me such a shake hand that shake hand tells me a lot of stories. But the shake hand tells me a lot of, not stories, a lot of things. No, I know why. Because once I had an opportunity to save his life. Okay. I have never gone about, and in fact, a lot of my intimate friends, including Rajmohan Nair, whom I share a lot of my aspirations and things, he doesn't know about two lives that I have saved. Okay. Because I think, you know, I don't want a credit for that, but this has actually happened. And we also don't speak much about this. Whenever we meet, we shake hand and go. But that shake hand is something so unique. Okay. What I'm trying to communicate is that this is the question of somebody having the lead to go and save that person. Yeah. Hello. This is about that element, that initiative in that person to go and save that person, you know. I could have left him go. I could have left him there and go and die, or I wouldn't have bothered. Okay, it was such a situation that nobody would have liked to go and save him, but somebody took the initiative of go and do it. Okay, so what I'm saying is that, you know, it is a question of it is Newton's law, Rajeshwari. It is a question of, you know, finding out equally opposite force, equally opposite and opposite direction force to remove you from the inertia that you have. Right. And I had seen so many people have that inertia. And there are umpteen number of lovely examples of individuals who from nowhere, with no qualification, okay, reached those positions that they aspired for. And I know that you know that there are at least some good souls that become about that. Okay. While I totally agree with you that we humans actually lack that level of an inertia breaking sentiments, there are possibilities within ourselves. And it is all the question of going very deep and seeing that, can I? And another, it is not an advice, it is not a suggestion, nothing, because he said about the world saying it. Okay, that is the biggest problem. Okay, first of all, Maro Goli. The world says this, Maro Goli. If you don't do that, you will never reach where you want to reach, because we're so much bound by all these opinions and suggestions and guidances and all those things. We have a lot of problem. And many times, we forget what we are, aren't we? Thank you, Rajeshwari. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you so much.
You've actually touched some light, some showed in my thinking. Thank you very much. Okay. Yes, any other question or any other statement that you would like to make? Madhav, we will call it a day, sir. Who is supposed to? We will finish just like that.
I think if we are done with the questions, probably.
Yeah, I think it's almost time.
Yeah, Madhav.
Go ahead.
No, please. No, I didn't. I thought you were not in the call, sir. Please, go ahead. Madhav?
Yes, Madhav.
Yeah, my connection got unstable. That's why I was just getting dropped in between. Yeah, I think if there are no more questions from anybody, I think we'll close it. Any other questions? I mean, one question, one last question if somebody wants to ask. Yes. People are so engrossed and involved. So I didn't feel like, you know, just withdrawing just like that. So now all you know why, you know, we're giving that question answer sessions during all the leader talks also to SR, you know, someone who enjoys it with this bundle of energy and the kind of enthusiasm and exuberance which he displays, you know, it is coming from within. It is not that he's putting it on. It is all quite natural, and you know, who else can do such a job? And he once again showed his true character, true way in which he's made of in this session also. And I'm sure, you know, this could be a good pointer to the events to come in the future also. I'm sure we will find suitable people, you know, similar to SR, better than SR, there are times, you know, could be inferior to yourself also, but then we'll get interesting people to give you useful and meaningful sessions like what we had today. This is all, you know, like we knew it, but then when SR says it with those kind of examples, it makes a lot of sense to each one of us. And then I'll be so happy that if this session has proved, you know, value full for each one of you present here and having some change and a lot of takeaways from that, that would be really gratifying for each one of us at KMA. To propose a formal vote of thanks, as always, our Honorary Secretary, Chartered Accountant, Jovan George, ever ready for that. All yours, Jovan.
Thank you, Madhav. A wonderful session. Let me first compliment Vivek for a great takeoff of the first MEP session on Ikigai, the Japanese, I would say, a theory or a life lesson. And SR has done it so very well, as the president said. You know, it comes from within, and SR's perspective is always different. As he mentioned, sometimes his sharpness, his involvement feels it cuts, and at times you feel it bleeds as well. But then today we found a completely different side of SR. So from the rules of the Ikigai, if I have one more minute to say, you know, the stay active and everything I was trying to relate to real life incidents. So we had in the Dodo Beta Ooty, when it was very misty, went for a trip, and I was past 50 at that time, even now. And then we had youngsters, engineering students. So we were all having a good time. So these guys came and asked us, they called me uncle. Uncle, and said, you guys are very active. What's the secret and all that? And they asked me for advice. They said, the only advice is don't grow old. So that is lesson one. And take it slow. We know I'm the story of Julian Mandel in The Monk Who Sold His Ferrari. There's a lot of things you say that from the fast lanes of life, very aggressive lanes of life, then cooling down a little bit and taking slow, as SR said on the Epita, somebody who died yesterday or somebody who's contented, that's really nice. Fill in your stomach, I have nothing much to say because I did that 2 hours back. So so just on that. And great friends make a huge, huge difference. Absolutely no doubt about it. I have been blessed to have very good friends. So they're just trying to relate to what we have been discussing now. And get in shape, yes, I would really endeavor. So our lessons are, though there have not been questions, but there have been very strong messages one would take. And smile, I think the most infectious thing that can, you know, really convey a lot of things. Connecting with nature, I would invite every one of you here to Wagamon. You know, and we have, you know, still hear the birds chirping, smell the flowers, and of course, rare birds and all those things we have with them. And giving thanks, yes, it is said that it's not the happy people who are thankful, it's the thankful people who are happy. And live the moment. Again, we have a Sunnichayan in Pala. Sunnichayan always says, don't worry about what your wife is going to do when you get back home late. Have a drink or spend the time here, sing a song and relax. Life is all about moments, and follow your Ikigai. The theory is so very well done by SR, and absolutely, absolutely. I could join only late, but then towards the roundup, I could make out the spirit of the whole lesson. I mean, all the whole session, and you know, see, this is not a lecture. These are lessons which we really need to take and apply in our lives. So let us take it forward. We beg once again compliments to the wonderful takeoff that you have done. And Asaji, no words to thank you. And let's continue this interaction. It can be offline also. In our informal interactions also, these kind of lessons would surely liven up our times together. So great going. Wish everyone a safe time, happy time, lesson from Ikigai. God bless. Thank you.